Hello.
Oh, hi. Can you hear me?
Hey. Yeah, I can hear you just fine.
Okay, great. Hopefully this stream doesn't crash. I don't know why. I can't see you, FYI. Oh, here it comes maybe. Oh, nice. Forehead action. Great.
Nice.
I like your freckles. Cute.
Thanks. How are you doing today?
Pretty good. Yeah. Okay, I'm going to like talk to you for a second and then we're going to jump into what we're doing, but I want you to know why we're doing it.
Okay. Just so you know, we're both streaming, right?
Yeah.
Okay, good.
Yeah, always. Yeah. I always want all my collaborations to be an excuse for other people to get new viewers. So stream. Everyone go check out Kyla's stream. I'm going to move me over. I'm going to move Kyla here. I forget what my streamers like me to do, but I think they like to see your whole face. Okay, oh my God, I'm going to freak out if this stream dies again on me.
How many times has it crashed today?
Not today yet, thank God. But like legit, when I was talking to Destiny, it crashed like 3 times talking to him. And then the other day it crashed on me. And it's just, I think the computer's just on. It's really been on its last leg for months. But I'm getting my computer built. And so we had some problems with some of the parts coming in. So hopefully this works out. Okay, I'm going to move this. Okay, y'all fine? Yes, we're both in the screen. We're both okay. I think this is it. By Jove, I think this is it. Okay, I'm going to move this out of way and move this. No, I'm going to put this back. Okay. Yes, let me just check on the chat. Oh, wait. Now you're going to see. Wait, I did it wrong. Sorry, chat. There we go. Okay. Hold on. Tell me again how her audio is and my audio is, guys. Dumb question. Wait, no, don't worry. All
check, check, day. Check.
Yeah, everything should be good. Okay, everything should be good. Okay. Hey, girly.
Hi.
Okay, so this is basically what's been going on. First, I spent all day in my Discord yesterday from like 8:30 to like 9. I was just like in my Discord chat. And we had lots of conversations about dating and cohabitation. And then I watched on stream your talk with Abba and Destiny. Okay. And one of the things that people kept telling me was like, Brittany, you're not a normie and these people are normies and they're trying to give advice to normies and you're trying to give advice to non-normies. And so I want to ask you, how do you feel about being... about that. Do you think you are catering to normies in your dating advice?
I think I'm pretty aware that my sample selection of viewers is going to be more terminally online and probably dominantly more men. But a lot of these people want to date normie people. So it's kind of teaching them what normies do in dating, I think is what I'm trying, is the goal.
So they're not necessarily normie.
No, I don't think many of there's a couple of normies in my viewership, but most of them are definitely terminally online.
Can we talk about,
like, I think if based is part of your common vocabulary, you're probably not a full normie anymore.
Okay. What is
especially if you say it out loud in public, like I do, then you're not.
Definitely. 100%. So wait, what does normie then mean? People who don't live online?
Yeah, people who are like way less involved in the online space. If you say something like PewDiePie, they have no idea who you're talking about.
Okay.
Like really disconnected from the YouTube streaming kind of internet world.
Interesting. Okay, because I think I process that, yes, that is true, but also that there's a normie part of YouTube. So like people who watch like
vloggers,
family vlogs, or like who are like the David Dobrik people, like people who are really like they're like generally for the normal teenager, right?
Yeah, I mean there's even like some political streamers that are normie, like
yes,
that people like tune into. But when we're talking about normies, we're typically talking about people who spend a fair bit of time on Reddit.
On Reddit?
On Reddit.
Normies
like they're
go on
decently
Reddit.
Aware. Yeah. Okay. No, normies no. don't.
Normies really don't go Reddit on Reddit. At all. That's what I
Not
meant.
Really.
Okay, just checking.
Yeah.
Okay.
And they go to Reddit for like their news, their science updates. There'll often be people who game a lot. They're probably very, very familiar with Discord and how to use it. Typically, one of my markers of a normie is they have no fucking clue how to work Discord.
Oh, that's hilarious. But wait a second. Why do people keep saying, like, Brittany, you're too normie for Erudite, Destiny, and ABBA?
I think because you are definitely more normie than the rest of us.
Like, sorry,
you're
rephrase.
Not super big on gaming.
No, rephrase. I'm not the normie. You guys are the normie. Sorry. They said you guys are the normies, which I kind of think, like, I see Destiny and Melina as, like, very normie open people, but not, like, queer BDSM open people.
I guess maybe now we're getting to like different uses of the word normie. So like if we're saying like BDSM culture, then yeah, I would definitely be like a normie.
Right.
But normie in that place almost just means not part of this small in-group.
Wait. People are saying I'm deaf the normie. So why would I be the normie?
In like the internet culture, you'd be more the normie because you're probably not super well versed on like a ton of like internet stuff, memes. You don't video game very often. I don't know how often you use Reddit, but
I don't like Reddit.
I'm dubious. Yeah, I don't think so. You touch grass a lot.
Yeah.
So that's always weird for us internet folk.
Okay, it's someone saying you're not as normie as Erudite or ABBA, and maybe Destiny is less normie. So it's like a spectrum, which I like. I like spectrums because it allows a lot of like nuance to occur. So, okay, the reason I wanted to do this little like mini date with you, and it's not going to be like heavy on the flirting or anything. It's actually going to be focused on compatibility. So some people believe that chemistry is more important than value compatibility. Some people think value compatibility is more important than chemistry. I have the issue that I have chemistry with just about everyone, I feel. So my issue is like when you have chemistry with a lot of people, it becomes difficult to know if you're really compatible because like I could fall in love on that chemistry, but then I'm going to divorce you later because we differ on reality, right? Farm Brother, my brother who owns a farm here, we call him Farm Brother because I don't share my siblings' names traditionally. And Farm Brother, he has a very specific way of dating. He's very traditionally attractive and women have been chasing him his whole life. He's married now and has three kids and one on the way, so four kids. And so he managed to find his like perfect Catholic like wife and all that stuff. But prior to that, he'd go on dates with girls and he'd go on only like one date, maybe two. And everyone was like, you're not giving these girls a chance. He's like, no, I already know. Like I asked them, are you Catholic? And they're like, no, great, next. He's like, that's easy, right? And people are like, that's crazy. And I get a lot of criticism for doing that now because in my 20s, I didn't. In my 20s, I would date people I thought I was so not compatible with, but I was like, well, let's see what happens. And then I ended up dating all these people for a few years at a time. And we would just like break up in the most like fiery crash way. And I'm like, why did we even do this in the first place? Right? Mm-hmm. So I want to pretend to go on a date with you. And I want to show people why people never get to a second date with me.
Okay.
Okay.
Sounds good.
So basically.
Are you going to kind of take the lead then?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So basically, just like a normal date, I don't know if you're straight, right? You've never gone on a date with a girl?
I've never gone on a date with a girl.
No. I feel like the best part about dating girls is that it's like dating a friend. So you just like show up, you're like, hey girl, what's up? What's your vibe? And so it's like a very like, it's very just like easy, I think, to date women. So we're at a coffee shop, let's say, and we're just like, we have our drinks and we're chilling. And it's like, oh, hi, Kyla. I'm Brittany. Nice to meet you.
Hi. It's super nice to meet you. I'm, as you said, I'm Kyla.
I'm really excited to have this date with you. How do you normally do your dates? Like, what's it like normally for you?
It's usually pretty chill. I mostly like try to find some activity we can do that just facilitates conversation. Cause the main goal in my view of a first date is just to like talk, as much as possible. But usually having an activity in the middle, like helps it be less awkward if there's like a lull in the conversation.
For sure. Well, good news is that I will not allow a lull to exist because I have tons of questions I want to ask you and I'm glad we can talk today. So, I obviously want to know everything about you. So like, what do you do for work?
Presently I work online. I do a lot of political debating on YouTube and Twitch.
Oh my gosh. Coming out right the gate telling me about your secret online life. What?
Yeah. Well, unfortunately it's the only life I have. So I gotta wear it on my sleeve.
Oh my gosh.
That's what you get.
Are you proud of your job? Do you like it a lot?
It's super fun. It's very different. I've had a much more like academic history in work. So it's a weird thing to like transfer of like, do I feel proud about it? I don't know yet I don't know what metric. I think I've based a lot of my, I'm proud based on like what a lot of people in society would be like, yeah, it's super cool that you've achieved this like academic success. So I'm not sure. What about you? What do you do?
I review pop culture and like philosophy stuff. And so it's kind of like fun and exciting, kind of similar, I guess. But yeah, I like to review and react to things.
Cool.
Yeah.
What's your favorite stuff to review?
Anything to do with relationships is like my thing. I like human, like just socialized, like people being social in general. So anything that has to do with us observing people and why they do what they do, that's like my obsession. You know, I'm always trying to figure it out. Like even now on this date, I'm kind of secretly trying to figure out what you're thinking. right?
Mm. Are you a mind reader? Are you good at mind reading?
I'm more of an intuitive human who tries to view the whole picture of, like, your facial expression, mix in with your tone of voice, mix in with, like, what you're wearing and how you feel. So that's what I'm kind of gauging off of.
Yeah.
So is that mind reading?
Sort of. I think like anytime you're intuiting like what people's intentions are, like kind of like what we would maybe in psychology call like the hidden agenda, is it like we would call it like it's a little bit of like mind reading, but it's not like, you know, like ESP where I'm like, I'm like actually mind reading you. Yeah.
Wait, so you have a background in psychology?
Yes. Yep. I've got training in psychology. That's kind of my muse.
So when you're on a date, are you like psychoanalyzing your date?
Probably, but probably the same amount that anyone does. Right. I try to keep any like counseling hats off of my head when I'm interacting with people, because I don't think people like that. So I try to keep that separate, but I think probably some of it necessarily bleeds in a little bit.
Yeah. I went on a date with this guy and he said, I feel like you're therapizing me. And I was like, oh, he's like, you know, I feel like I'm being like examined and torn apart. And I was like, you are. You 100% are. And I was like, don't you just do it naturally, though? And he was just like, no, at all. And I was like, oh, but do you do it naturally? Because I just do it naturally. It just happens.
I don't know how people don't interact with others and then think about the other person and try to, like, understand the world. Like, to me, that, like, when people are like, are you psychoanalyzing? I'm like, am I trying to, like, understand you as a complex person, what you think and feel? And then, like, based on that, I make some level of prediction about how I think you're going to react to different things to, like, essentially test my hypothesis of what I've kind of drawn you, yes, what my mental images of you, I test it. And it's like, I don't know why people wouldn't be doing these things.
Yeah, obviously.
How else do you get to know somebody if you're not like, right? Trying to understand who they are?
I wonder if they do it and they feel like a bad about it because they feel like they might be judged maybe. Because I was thinking about this in relation to myself. Like, if, you know, if we end up dating long term, I really want to tell my partner everything. I hope you're okay with that idea. But, like, I want to tell you everything, right? Like, I don't have any secret crazy thoughts. Like, I mean, I do. They're kind of, like, not normie. But they're not really truly out of this world. What do you think about that? Do you like to tell your partner everything?
Like, every single thought that's ever popped into my head?
If they want to hear it. Yeah, like, within reason, obviously.
Yeah, I think, I don't know. I feel like for partnerships and long-term relationships, I'm looking for somebody to like be my best friend. Mm. And like, I kind of always say like, I want somebody like, this is going to be really intense, but like in the trenches with me, you know, like they're kind of there for it. And so, I would want to be able to feel comfortable. I don't know if I would share everything that comes into my mind, but I would want to feel comfortable that I could share whatever came into my mind with them.
I like that. I actually think that's probably, I should start saying it that way, where I want to tell my partner everything within reason, meaning not to overwhelm them, but to give them access to me, to let them know I'm not hiding anything from you. Out of all the people on this planet that I hide things from every day, you're the one person I don't want to hide anything from.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, and I do want to feel safe enough that they can handle whatever I might tell them. So, okay, that's exciting. I'm glad we have that in common, at least. That's really nice.
Yeah.
Yeah. Can I ask you a harder question? Or a more like...
Absolutely.
Okay, hopefully this doesn't ruin everything, but do you believe in God?
Yes, I do.
How much? Like, what kind of relationship do you have with God?
I'd say it's like decently central to my life, but it's something that's also deeply, deeply personal. I don't know if I would ever expect it from my
Okay. I don't usually, I don't date people who believe in God because I don't believe in a God. It's not that I know that she or he is not real. It's just that I don't have any reason to believe in a God. Kind of like I don't have a reason to believe in vampires, though I love the idea of those being real, both of them. So I'm not going to lie. I'm kind of already like, oop, this makes me go, not red flag, because that's not fair. Like, you didn't answer wrong. But I don't know how to cohabitate with somebody that believes in something I don't.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Oh, my God. Did this date just come to an end?
If that's where you're at and you wouldn't want to go any further. I mean, we can keep hanging out if you just want to, like, chat and have a nice time. But, yeah, I think that's, like, if that's a big no for you.
It is a big no. Is it a big, like, I'm just checking, like, for sure, because you're so beautiful and I love your brain already. Like, God is definitely going to be part of your life for a long time.
Basically, okay. Like, unless something happens that I would, which it always could. Like, I kind of always say, like, I don't know how I still believe. I've just, like, had enough experiences where I can't not. But it's possible that in the next 10 years I'll have enough experiences that I can't.
Okay, that's fair. Yeah. That's fair. Okay, well, thank you so much for this date. I really appreciate it. Let's just keep talking as friends then.
Okay. Sounds good.
So how long did that date last? I should have timed it. Did we last? How long did we go? We only lasted like, what, 5 minutes maybe?
I think it was like 10 minutes.
10 minutes? So, okay. Literally, I could have asked you any other question. Like, I could have asked you, do you want to like live out in the country? Do you want to live in the States? I could have asked you like so many things that would have made us like not compatible. Right. What do you think about that? Do you think that that's really strange that somebody wouldn't date someone because they don't believe in God?
Not at all. I think it totally makes sense. I think overall it's something I would broadly recommend. Mm. I think especially like a lot, like, to be honest, even for me, I don't know if I would date somebody who believes in God.
What? Kyla!
I know. Like, in the future, like, say, like, if Nick died or we got divorced, like, I actually don't know if I would. What? Because most people who believe in God are pretty unbearable and, like, rigid. So, yeah.
Wait, maybe we are compatible. Skirt. What is your relationship with God again? I'm confused. Like,
I know. A lot of people are going to be, like, really thrown. It's because I have, like, a very, very different way I think of like understanding God. And so this is why I'm always hesitant to even tell people about my beliefs ever and getting into religion, is because I know exactly what it means to people when they hear that. And yeah, it's super fair that they feel that way. Mm. And it doesn't really capture me at all. But I also don't want to lie and say that I don't believe in God or something like that, because I do. I just also know that with that comes all of the baggage. And I'm like, I fully agree with you, which is why I'm like, if I was dating somebody and they said like, yes, I'm a Christian, I'd be like, like, now of course I wouldn't end the date right there, because that would be hypocritical, because I'm within that bubble too, right? And yeah, I'm like, well, they could be a weirdo like me who's like, yes, they use the label, but it doesn't really mean anything. But it would definitely be like a yellow flag for me, which I think is probably weird for people to hear.
That, okay, that is actually what happens though in Catholic bubbles as well, because there's different kinds of Catholics. So when my brother was dating and people be like, I'm Catholic, he's like, what kind of Catholic? Once a year Catholic, go to church Catholic, Latin Catholic, Orthodox Catholic, like what kind of Catholic? And then people are like, oh my God, there's all different kinds. And he'd be like, date's over. Because we're like hardcore like Roman Catholic, but we also do the Latin Mass. And then we went to Bible study our whole life. Like, our friends are priests. Like, we have so many connections to the church. So for us, like, our Catholicism is much more ingrained in the bubble. So even within Catholic bubbles, there's like different, just like with queer bubbles, there's different kinds of queer bubbles, right? So I love that. Now, as much as people are excited for you to have a second chance and for me to have a second chance at love here, I think what I'm actually, what I really want to explore with you is sort of, I'm getting the vibe from like listening to you and Abba and Destiny talk about relationships, that a lot of what you guys assume is normal is like settling. And I wanted to ask you if that's true. Is that an assumption on my end?
I wouldn't say settling. Okay. I would say compromise. And so like what I would say is there are certain things that are hard non-negotiables and you have to know what they are and be really clear about them. And then there are other things, and the non-negotiables are going to differ by people. Like, I can't tell you what they are because they're going to be different for you, right? And just be really clear that, like, this is something I cannot ever work around. And just know any non-negotiable you have inherently shrinks your pool.
Yes.
And so it's up to you. You can have a million non-negotiables and have a pool of 10 actual viable possible partners. And that's your choice. You get to do that, right?
Yes.
But just know the more non-negotiables you have, the more you're shrinking your pool and the more that people have to be okay with your non-negotiables. Yes. And you have to be okay with theirs, right? So settling is tricky because I think settling means different things to people. So I guess I would ask, like, what do you mean by settling?
Settling to Brittany means I'm going to cohabitate with someone or fall in love with somebody that not exactly what I want, but actually holds or has values that bother me. And I'm settling so I'm not alone.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So basically, like, you don't like something, but you're like willing to ignore it.
Not make peace with it, but like literally either zing or, you know, in my case, probably drive myself crazy.
Yeah. And so I guess like, I think there's actually a really unique difference in like men and women when they talk about settling. Mm. Like when men talk about settling, it's almost exclusively like, it would be nice if there was this, but I'm okay if there isn't, is typically what I think a lot of men mean when they say settling. Whereas for women, I will say it does seem that women have a really, really high bar. A lot of women for like what they won't settle for, like things that I'm like, I don't actually know if these are non-negotiables or need to be. You get to make them. It's just like your pool is going to be teeny tiny.
Yes.
Especially if you're only wanting men, for example. But I think a lot of times women mean I'm willing to give up a non-negotiable when they say settling, which is just a different way that I think the word is used. So when when you hear me talking with men, I'm going to be using the settling that they're talking about, which is like, I'd like it, but I don't need it, basically.
Okay, yeah. When I think of settling, I think of the other one where it's a non-negotiable. Or in BDSM, we call them hard limits versus soft limits. And so I think about that too. Like Destiny gave me the most outrageous example the other day. I called into a show and he was like, okay, you meet the most perfect person. I was like, I want to know everything about them. He's like, okay, you meet the most perfect person, but they secretly think about fucking puppies. And I'm like, okay, first of all, that's hardly like perfect, but okay.
Yeah.
And he was like, well, would you want them to tell you that or just keep it secret for the rest of your life? And I was like, I prefer not dating someone who wants to fuck puppies. Can I have that preference?
Well, it's just like I don't know. We kind of understand like just because like – we're not comfortable with a society that has people that have, like, we don't like people in our society that are okay with this, even if we don't know like why it's wrong. And it's like, we kind of cluster a bunch of things. Like if they're fucking puppies, like what kind of weird mental leaps are they going through to like justify that in their head? You know?
Right. Right. Cause I want to know why a person thinks the way they do. I think about that all day for myself. So when I'm thinking about, and again, partnership, just to clarify guys, I'm not talking about lovers. I'm not talking about fuck buddies. I'm not talking about casual. I'm not talking about people that I like hang out with. I'm talking about long-term cohabitation, which to Brittany means until we die. I'd prefer not to get a divorce and I'd prefer not to separate if I don't have to, but I understand because we believe in consent that that might happen and my partner might one day decide they want to go in a different direction, which I'm okay with logically, but emotionally it tears me up inside.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's fair.
You know, I want to have the balance of both existing. And when I'm listening to like ABBA and you and Destiny, it makes me feel like I think all of life is basically a construct. So I don't really like the idea of dating having to be a particular way. As if there is a right way to date or a wrong way to date. I feel like the best way to date is in the way that makes you feel the most comfortable. And then you're probably going to be around people that are also in that same sphere of feeling comfortable. And then you can hang out together. And I wanted to know what you thought about that since you do a dating show.
Like the idea of basically like being, are you talking about like being friends before essentially? Like or when just, you're saying like being comfortable.
Am I saying that? Maybe. Maybe I'm trying to say that, like, when I go into a date, I just like, hi, what's your name? What do you do? And what do you like? Do you believe in God? Yes. No. How'd you vote? Okay. Noted. And see how we deviate here. Thank you. Bye.
Like the systematic. Are you asking about your dating style? How systematic it is?
Well, I'm saying mostly like, I don't know if there's a script, but I'm saying I feel like these bubbles are saying there's like a script. And that, I feel like that is true in certain bubbles. And I'm saying yes. I don't really believe in the need to follow a script. But I'm also okay with being single, so I'm the anomaly because I think everyone else wants to be partnered in the world. Well, no.
Right.
Needs to be partnered because I do want to be partnered very much.
But yeah. I just
don't need it, you know?
Sorry, my dog keeps
saying. I hear it.
When I'm talking dating strategies with people and stuff, like the reality is like, I guess if I'm using your language, like I'm mostly talking about like twos dating other twos and like how to do that. And so like I'm realizing the reality of like certain bubbles that we all live in. And I know the scripts that are broadly expected in the North American bubble, right? I'm pretty clear that, like, for example, somebody who's on the dating show, I'm not necessarily giving them advice about dating in like Sudan.
Okay.
Because that's going to be really culturally different. And the way that the like courtship specifically would play out is going to be really, really different. I'm trying to be just really honest about like,
sorry.
It's so cute. I think cute. She's got a dog outside and she just like can't.
It's,
just
I live can't with a husky. It's, I'm used to it. It's so cute.
Okay. Yeah. It'll continue for a
cutie,
while, I'm assuming.
Cutie.
And so I basically like help people run down of like, I get people who don't want to work within that. And so like, if you find somebody who lives and like doesn't care about these things, that's great. And you guys like don't need to date based on like certain skills, but there are certain skills that you can learn. Like for example, like flirting skills.
Mm.
I think flirting skills, even if you're dating in the style, like your much more direct style, some people, I kind of think that like there's three dominant ways. There might be more, but there's three major social skills people need to develop, which is basic social skills, which is like engaging with people platonically at a level, emotionally level playing field, small talk, most of what we do.
Okay.
Right. And then there's confrontation skills. And within there is boundary setting, but also like confronting somebody or like dealing with anger or like tension between two people. I think that that's actually a separate social skill that people need to learn. And we don't actually learn it very well. And third is actual sexual tension skills. So navigating and talking about sex, sexuality, and the tension that comes with it. Because the feeling that you have in your body when you're like navigating sexually tense conversations or situations is very different than the other two, right?
Yes, ma'am.
And so that's what I want to do is I want to like create a space basically where people who are like, I suck at this third one. I'm really bad at talking in any level of sexuality. I just want to like help them be exposed over and over and over until they basically get comfortable with it.
Yeah.
And so while there's a bit of a prescriptions that I give people, like this is broadly what seems to work within our society for like dating skills and stuff like that. I also want to give just like flirting skills are going to be dynamic. They're going to look different to every personality, but everyone probably needs to develop, especially mostly men, because in our society, men are typically the pursuers. They distinctly need to have some level of skill with flirtation and navigating
sexual
dynamics.
And maybe even
dynamics.
A script would be more comforting too if they were the pursuers, I'm sure. I just go for intimidate, overwhelm, and disarm.
Hey, at least you're aware of your skills.
That's usually what I do.
Full dom.
Yeah, I just try to suffocate people into feeling so much like a bottom that they're like, oh my God, do whatever you want to me. And I'm like, meh, meh, meh. But like, here's the thing, right? I'm always confused about like the ethics around that because I was telling my Discord yesterday, I have a tendency to like overwhelm and like suffocate people into feeling like there is no one here but you and me, which makes people go, I am special. I am special. I'm getting this thing that is like in romance books. But Brittany is using it for what goal? So then I was thinking about goals because I know Eb and Destiny were talking about how like being fairly attractive can get you places. When I hear men in America specifically or over in this area talk about dating, I often feel like what I'm hearing them say is, I just need a woman who's hot.
Yeah.
And so my brain goes, well, I'm out. Next. Not because I'm not hot, but I'm niche pretty. It's different than being hot. I don't see myself as a hot person.
Right.
When I think of hot, I think of like Melina. You know what I mean? It's just like a hot girl.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know what I mean? It's just like, damn. Like aesthetically pleasing to most cultural bubbles, right?
Like everyone would agree that she's just attractive.
Yes. Versus me, I often hear like, oh, you're very niche pretty. And I'm like, yeah, I got it. And I'm like, thanks, I got it. You know?
A really nice backhanded compliment.
Uh-huh. Which is like, okay.
You're pretty to some people.
To some people.
Okay. So that means, but not to you, I'm guessing. Okay.
No, right? That's what it feels like. But that means that my niche dating skill is going to be based off of those bubbles that do think I'm attractive.
Mm.
Right? So, of course, my success rate is better because I know who likes me.
Right.
Versus if you're generally pretty, you might not know who likes you versus everyone just liking you.
Right.
Which must be really hard. And then if you're ugly, whatever that means, because, you know, that's subjective, then you are the thing that no one likes, so you have no game.
Yeah, it's really interesting. When you're typically in the pursued position, which usually women are in that role, there's a whole different set of skills that I think women need to cultivate broadly and, like, pursued individuals. That is different than the pursuer. Like the pursuer needs to actually build their flirtation and their pursuit skills essentially. And like when I'm talking about pursuit, I'm basically saying like, in my view, if you're the person who's going to be like more leading in the relationship, you're going to be asking on the dates, you're going to be maybe initiating the kisses, you're obviously going to be more often be paying for food or like asking the other person on the date, right? That's the pursuer role, which typically men occupy. I would say pursuers need to learn a bunch of skills. In my view, the most ethical way to be a pursuer is that maximizes the person you're pursuing's agency at all times. Ooh. So every time you're basically like leading to like another level of like flirtation, maybe kissing, you're also like asking in a way that makes it as easy as possible for that person to reject you and also gives them the option obviously to reject you. So it's not just consent, but it's also maximizing it so that like consent can be given in the easiest way possible. Pursued people, I think, actually have to navigate the skill of basically vetting. Like they need to figure out how they vet between people and a lot of people tell pursuers, like a lot of women I hear give each other advice of like, start shit testing men. And I'm like, don't shit test men. Don't
what does that
do
even
that.
Mean? Does that mean like put them through like, what does that mean? Because I have an idea.
Give them like a fake boundary that you don't care about.
I hate
just
that.
To see how they react to it. And it's just mean, it's super manipulative and it's mind fucking, right? Because if you tell them that this is a boundary and they're super chill with it, they're going to be respectful and assume that that's your fucking boundary. And if it was always a lie, then later when you like so maybe weird. Ask them, why are you not crossing this boundary? They're going to be like, what? You said that this was a boundary, right? So it's just super mind fucking. I really hate shit testing. But there's other like things that women can learn to like do things that like keep them safe and also like vet people in a way that also, again, maximizes your pursuer's agency like as much as possible. I really, really hate mind fucking, which is a lot of dating games that happens. And so when I'm giving, that's what pickup artists do, is a lot of mind fucking. And so what I try to pull apart is like, what are the actual behavioral skills that pickup artists do that are effective? And then how do we make these like ethical?
Oh, I like that actually, because I'm a heavy flirt. I like putting it all out there. And I also like, I like making people feel, because I like that too, like it's very BDSM-y. This is a scene. No one's here. It's just me and you in this little bubble and literally nothing matters, which is much easier than, but I'm also very into casual if I need to be. So I guess the difference is like I'm one generation removed. Is that how I say it? Like my mom's generation, you weren't a floozy. Like you wouldn't do what I was doing today. It would be super, super, super bad. You know, I wouldn't even have pursuers. Like I know in today's age, people are like, Brittany, you're not going to find a partner if you're on OnlyFans. Specifically a straight men, because obviously bisexual men tend not to care, and I've noticed queer women obviously don't care, traditionally speaking. So what they're really trying to say is like straight men, who are the majority, won't be your pursuers, which I'm okay with, though I do get pursued by them. I haven't been with a straight guy in a really long time.
Oh, really? Do you prefer more like bi?
I always try to date bi people.
LGBT?
As much as I can date queer people. And some variation of queer. Like Destiny's variation of queer is queer enough for me. It's just the idea that he's willing to suck a dick is like, great, that works. It's like, because what you're signaling to me is you're willing to be open to the possibilities of trying something different and unique, regardless of how the world's going to view you.
Right.
Because right now, the worry I have is that I don't want to date someone who's still worried about what the world thinks. It's like, boo-boo. I want to know what you're going to be worried about when we're alone. Like, I'm worried about the world, too, but, like, separate from me, not in relation to me, if that makes sense.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, what are they doing so I know what to do next?
Okay. So you want somebody that's, like, basically, like, fully self-integrated? Like, they don't rely on the world for any, like, sense of value or meaning?
Right.
Okay.
Right. Yeah, because even with this job, like sometimes I'll get feedback from my viewers like, oh, Brittany, I noticed in your stream, like there was a lull. Or, oh, hey, Brittany, I realized like, hey, you don't want to lose viewers, right? And I was like, literally don't care. And they're like, don't you? And I was like, nope. Like I've been doing the same thing on YouTube for like 12 years. Like what I want. It's doing great. Like I have no issue. So that's the problem is my life, even though it's been I've had major ups and downs and a lot of like bad things, going my own way has always ultimately been the best method for me. So when I give advice, I know the rest of the world is getting normie advice. I know normies have the TV shows and the news outlets and the fucking Cosmopolitan and all that stuff. I used to be obsessed with all that stuff.
Right.
But I am concerned that the world is shortchanging themselves or like not allowing themselves to have more variety even in their normie relationships because they don't want to be considered not normie. But I feel like BDSM and poly in terms of communication and open negotiation and consent is like would hugely benefit normie circles.
Do you date within your BDSM community or is that like a hard no as well? Yeah.
I date everyone. Like I date fans. I'll date fans. I'll date at church. I'll date at the supermarket. I think once you're adults, we're all options for something. But the only caveats I have is like age. Like I don't date younger people. I'll fuck them, but I will not date them.
And when you're saying younger, you mean over 18, obviously.
Always over 18.
Because I know what viewers are going
to
do with
I'm 33,
that.
Guys. Younger to me is 24, 26, 27, 28, younger. But yes, I'm 33. So I have no problem with like physical adult interaction. Once you're 18, I just don't see the issue. I think it's a made up issue. But I also know that what the issue, which is not made up, is that older people can take advantage of younger people. And I think that is different because that has nothing to do with that's not the age. That's literally the individuals involved.
Right. So we use age as like a heuristic for like maturity and power typically.
Which I'm doing by saying I won't date under 30. People are now saying, Brittany, you're cutting yourself off. But Kyla, I'll tell you a secret. Do you want to know a secret? Do you really think if a 29-year-old showed up who was perfect, I wouldn't marry a 29-year-old?
I'm sure it's our heuristic as well. It's a rule of thumb.
Yeah. So, like, I think people do this thing where, because I'm such, like, a black and white about a lot of things, they're going to be like, that's a hard limit for her. I never said that.
Right.
But I want to act like it is, so I'll derail all the 22-year-olds from sliding into my DMs. Stop. I'm really not going to date a 22-year-old, though. That's really never going to happen.
That's fair.
But they seem to like me a little bit, you know? So it's like, which is so sweet.
It's probably the energy, right? Like, because you're so high energy that I think, like, younger people.
Yes.
Especially younger people tend to look at, like, really high energy women as, like, the kind of the ideal.
Really?
And then I think so, yeah.
Oh,
I think a lot that. Of, like, younger people associate, especially, like, men, they associate high energy women with, what's the archetype called? There's a film archetype about this. I think it's maybe called The Pixie, but it's basically like a really high energy girl who's kind of like flitzy and cute and like is kind of like a fairy in a lot of ways. And then typically with the archetype, they're also like really emotionally volatile.
Is that Manic Pixie Girl?
Wild great sex. Is that what it's called? Yeah. Manic Pixie Girl?
I am the Manic Pixie Girl. So somebody said that to me yesterday. They're like, I think Brittany, appears to be, and I'm like, no, is. Like, I've always been the Manic Pixie Girl. I'm like 5'1" and very like loud and theatric, and I also like actually do suffer from mania. So it's like perfect, and I'm really into sex, and I'm like really good at it, and I pay attention to it like a skill. And so all that stuff. And then I'm like up and down, but obviously now that I'm 3 years into being in recovery from borderline and everything. So obviously, like, it's a different kind of manic pixie. It's more like a manic pixie who's an adult. So I think the 22-year-olds are into me too, because I give off mommy energy now, which is like really great. And I love that so much. And I'm like way in my top headspace now, which is really great. Like, I love that energy, but it is specific. So I think, like, when I look at dating, all I see is like a lot of traps, and I see a lot of minefields, and I see a lot of anxiety. And so when I'm talking about dating, I want people to just consider that even though this is the rule in your bubble, maybe just like remove or bend or disregard the rule.
If they want to,
obviously. Yeah. But I hear a lot of complaining from these people who are like, Brittany, you don't know how hard it is out here. Even Destiny goes, Brittany, you don't know how hard it is out here. And I'm like, see, why is what I'm doing differently harder than them? We're both not finding partners. We're both like coming home alone. The difference is that I don't need a partner. But I don't even think these people need partners. I think they're just convinced they do because their life sucks in every other way that they can't think of anything to fix it except a partner for some of the people.
Yeah. And a lot of them, I think, want it as well, right? Like, they really, really want a partner. It's kind of like the one thing in their life that, like, they can't really fill that desire with anything else other than, like, that intimate human connection.
Well, either can I, though. But that's why I want it and don't need it. Because needing it would make me... If I needed it, girl, then now I'm in a position where... Well, I guess we can explore that in a more honest way. Maybe I do need it. I just... Saying I need it is so fucking weird to me. Because that's like saying I need to force someone to fall in love with me. Because it takes someone else's consent. So to say you need a relationship... To me, is like saying, I don't know, it feels wrong. It's like saying I need to have sex. It's like, okay, no, you don't.
Right.
And do you need it so much that you're willing to like do something bad to get it?
Right.
Because I don't need anything that bad. You know what I'm saying? Does that make sense? Or is that a Brittany way of using
it? Yeah, no, that does make sense. Yeah, no, that does make sense. I'm understanding what you're saying of like, if you're at the space in relationships where you can't not have it, then that also is going to leave you open to being willing to make certain compromises or settle on certain things, or maybe even like pressure others to settle for things that they're not really willing to, and you don't want to. Like, it sets up the grounds for an unhealthy relationship because it's starting from a space of essentially like, basically like codependence, essentially. Like, it's starting from a space of I need you, and I can't not be without you, which is a lot of pressure to put on another person.
Yes, that's what I don't like. I don't like that desperate energy of like, I need this. I'm like, do you? Because now I don't know if you want me or if you need someone so desperately and I'm just here.
Yeah.
Which would drive me crazy. And also like, it would drive me crazy because I do want to know everything my partner's thinking. So if they're like, I just don't, I mean, what about, I don't want to ask like, what about you? But like, kind of, what about you? Like, why did you choose Nick?
Good question. I think Nick definitely, so I thought Nick was hot. But I was actually in a space at that point in my life. I was pretty young already, but I think I realized that basically like the niche of like what I was like looking for in a relationship. I think I realized the niche I was asking for was literally so small. And I didn't know if I offered enough to even like essentially to interest a person from within that niche that I basically was like, I'm probably going to be single for a really long time. And either I need to I basically need to do enough self work so that part of the reason that my niche was so small is because of my own stuff. It wasn't all healthy reasons or good reasons. A lot of it was I'm kind of fucked up and that's just where I'm at. Right. So I realized that it was so small that I was it's unlikely I'm going to find anyone. I should probably just keep working on myself because part of the reason it's so small is because I'm pretty fucked up. So I should probably work on myself so that it can widen. So I really wasn't looking, and I had settled myself to being I'm probably going to be single for another 5 to 10 years. Just because I knew I had.
How old were you when you were going through this thought process?
Oh gosh. When did we meet? We've been together for almost 5 years. So math, 22. I would have been 22. Okay. Yeah, so super young. But I was pretty introspective at this time enough to know that I was fucked up.
Yeah.
And that it was going to take a while. And just the niche, I said, even then I was kind of the view of I don't really want to date somebody who's a Christian, but I also don't want to date somebody who's going to have issues with my religion. So that's immediately a really small niche.
Yeah.
Right. So I just knew that it was a really small niche. So I'd kind of just been I'm probably not going to find anyone. And the people who occupy that probably aren't going to be interested in me anyway. So I just accepted that. And then Nick showed up at camp and he was super hot. And I was always, so my favorite thing at cause I was at a Christian camp, and my favorite thing to do when I'm in the Christian bubble is I'm very naughty and I like to just poke and make things uncomfortable. So when we're having girls devo time, I'm like, okay, girls, who would you guys make out with of the male camp counselors? I just think it's fun. And it's human, right?
You are a rebel.
I know, I'm such a rebel, but I just want to remind people, Christians, of being you can be human. It's okay.
Yeah.
Right. So we'd have all these fun, it was crazy. Cause I literally, they'd be well, I wouldn't make out with anyone unless they're my boyfriend. I'm like, okay, well imagine you're on a desert island and the only way you guys get saved is you have to make out.
Did
they with
all
somebody.
Choose Nick? Was Nick a counselor?
Who was on the island? No. There's a bunch of really tall guys there that year. So they were winning out. Nick's pretty short. And then I had said Nick because I thought he was super hot. Mm-hmm. He'd got the body, he was clean shaven with the curly hair. So he had very surfer vibes.
Nice.
But when I'm at camp, I do not pursue relationships because my first year of camp, I had this realization that basically I talked about this with Dylan actually, but I've always cared about the at-risk. They were kids from really broken homes. So typically foster homes, group homes, homeless or single parent home. So kids that really needed love desperately. And I've always cared about those kids. And then I remember one week, one of the kids that I really connected with went home and I knew that they were going home to nothing. They lived in a group home. Nobody loved them. Their mom had passed away. They've never met their dad. There was just nobody in their life. And it's just everything changed for me. Being at camp, all that mattered to me was pouring every inch of myself into loving on these kids and just treating them well, essentially. Mm-hmm. So when I was at camp, I was not interested in actually flirting. If the kids were there and a guy was attempting to flirt with me in any ways, it was a hard fuck off. So Nick didn't, but he had a different view, which is basically, you know what kids love? Gossip. You know what's exciting gossip to be a part of? Camp counselor crushes.
True.
So he was super open with his kids about his crush. So he was
with
into
you,
me
so
and
he
another
was into
girl.
You? Oh, and another girl.
Yeah, me and another girl. Oh yeah.
Okay.
Nick threw the net wide.
Nice.
Yep.
Nice.
And so it was funny. We're both horse girls. We're very similar in a lot of ways. So he definitely has a type.
That's cute. That's
so
funny.
I heard about that and I was very annoyed because I was like, that's not what camp's for. And I was just very rigid in my view of that. So yeah, he was interested in me and I was like, don't fucking talk to me. Then we went on a canoe trip with just staff and I was on a canoe with him, almost died. We're in this area that has microenvironments.
Mm-hmm.
It's kind of between two mountains and it's this 22 kilometer long lake. And so these random clouds will roll in and you'll just get hit with an insane thunderstorm in less than 30 minutes when it was blue skies, which is amazing unless you're on a very small canoe. On this very large lake, which we were, and it was glacially fed. So the you can't fall in and
you'll
get hypothermia very quickly. Yeah. So anyways, I was on a canoe with him And he unironically probably like did for sure save my life. Cause like, yeah, it was crazy. We almost tipped like multiple times and I'm not good at boating. I'd never canoe. Whereas he was like the canoe guy. Like he took kids on canoe trips all the time. That was like his role. So he was like a big outdoorsy guy.
But why was it tipping? I don't get it.
The swells of the waves. So the canoe, it was like a steel canoe that was about 2 feet tall. And then the waves were about 3 feet tall.
Oh my
and
God.
So we basically would like face the waves while the wind was blowing just so that we didn't tip. And the moment he'd be standing and looking ahead, and the moment the waves went down, he would turn the canoe like this and scoot as fast as we could towards the shoreline just to get off the water. Yeah, it was really crazy, actually. And I was hypothermic by the time we got to the shoreline and stuff like
that. Even though you fall in, you just got with the splash and stuff?
Because I was just in a bathing suit and shorts.
Yeah. I'm not going to lie. It's kind of a fear of mine to die by cold.
Yeah.
Sounds scary. So, okay, so that was it. Was that the moment where you're like, at least I'm going to die with a hot man next to me? Or like, were you like into him at that moment? Or what were you thinking?
I was mostly just focused on not dying. But when we got back and everything was settled and we were having camp that night, we were just like talking and looking at the stars. And just the whole time, like he was like laying next to me and it was just like nice. Like I just was like, this is really nice. And I was like, shit, I think I might be into him. But I was very much in denial. Like I was like, yeah, he's just cute. And we just like had a really good conversations. They were really deep. I didn't realize that he was like as introspective and stuff. And so he definitely piqued my interest. And then we went back to camp and I ignored him for the next month. And then after camp, he just started texting me fairly often.
So he would
just
like, though, a month?
You know.
Damn.
Yeah, I know. So he would like text me. My story with Nick is not the story I recommend to women. Like I was truly like toxic femme in every way. Not in every way, but in a lot of ways, like very hot and cold and stuff like that. So yeah, he was just texting me a bunch, asking me questions about psychology and just like weird stuff like that, making conversation, but was never like too pushy.
Yeah.
So he would just text me and I would respond and we'd like have a conversation for a little bit and then it would die out. And then he like text me a couple weeks later about like Freud or like some random thing about psychology.
Man, this man really trying to get in, bro. He's like, that's so cute. Yeah.
Yes. And in fairness, he was pursuing me and one other person still at that time. And then he got to go on a snowboarding trip with the other girl.
Fun.
Was snowboarding with her, kind of realized being like, yeah, she's not really what I'm into. I don't even remember why. I think like basically conversationally, like she was less interested in like philosophy. Like he's really into philosophy and stuff and she just wasn't. And
what
I
do you
am,
think
so.
About that? Do you have an issue that you guys were not exclusive or anything and you guys were hardly even like, you weren't dating in a real way, right? So like it makes sense that he'd be talking to two girls, right?
Oh yeah, for sure. Yeah.
Okay. Cause I feel like that's like when I go on dates with people, it's one of the first things we talk about is sort of like, like, how do you feel about that? What do you want? What do you expect from that? And unless, like, we were literally a couple, I wouldn't even expect commitment. Like, that idea is so weird to me. But I also know that's pretty typical, though. I think in normie circles, don't girls get offended when guys are talking because they think they're players?
It depends on, like, the level of, like, how much and what they're talking about. And then, like, yeah, I think younger girls especially get kind of, like, weird about that. But I also think in a lot of, like, secular, like, popular dating, people are used to like, especially with dating apps, that like you're just talking about things for a while, but at some point it should become exclusive. And I think a lot of people have a hard time drawing that line of when it should be exclusive.
I just feel like it's when I can, like when I literally don't want to, when I just literally want to spend enough time with someone that I'm like, okay, you're now my new favorite thing and I want to talk to you all the time. That's when I decide, I guess. That sounds very borderline. Right. You're my new favorite thing. It's like, that's not what I mean, though. We actually discussed that yesterday. Like, have I ever – I don't know if I experienced the favorite person thing. I don't know what that means yet. Even though I've done DBT and all that stuff, every time it's explained to me, I, like, don't get it. But I think I have another Brittany problem where I'm probably doing it but in a different way. So it doesn't coincide with what it means. But I wonder, like, with mental health stuff, how do you – and I want to hear the end of the story. But, like, how do you think it coincides with when you're dating – like, are you, I don't know if you and Nick ever, like, you had, like, diagnosable mental issues, but, like, do you ever think about how that plays into it as well? Like, when are people supposed to say they have mental illnesses? What does a mental illness mean when socializing? All of that stuff.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, it's so tough. I generally, like, say as a rule of thumb, like, it's probably better to let somebody know sooner than later, particularly, like, they should know before something is going to, like, come up. right? And so when it comes to like certain mental health disorders, A, who knows when it's going to come up, right? Especially if you're like in the middle of getting treatment for something, you're like, I might suddenly just like have an episode of like depression that hits and I didn't plan it. Right. So like, when do I let people know? I think it probably also differs based on like how much it's going to impact the other person, right? So like, if you can't predict when a depression is going to happen, it's probably worth at some point letting people know, like, I'm in therapy, stuff like that. Somebody like with autism, I'm pretty big on like, you should probably let people know like sooner than later, particularly because you're going to communicate in a pretty different way. And if they don't know why you're communicating in a different way, a lot of people read into it.
Yeah.
So it's really going to be dependent on the individual, the level that it affects you, and the level that it affects people around you.
Mm-hmm. That makes sense. Now, someone says a gigachad move to save a girl on a first date. Do we recommend putting a girl in danger in order to save her on a first date?
Putting a girl in danger to save her? What is that? What's an example? Because
Nick
of that?
Saved you and it was kind of hot.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. I mean, he didn't plan to have a massive storm roll.
But should we orchestrate a situation?
I don't think you should orchestrate putting anyone's life in danger.
Fine. I actually hate that version of like any kind of like manipulation, testing, or orchestrating. Yeah. I actually really fucking hate.
Yeah, I mean, like, you can orchestrate, like, what would be a really beautiful date. Mm. You might even orchestrate, like, you know, dates that, like, get your heart racing so that, like, they might misattribute their heart racing to, like, feelings for you. Like, that's on the edge where I'm like, I don't know if I would do it, but I can see people doing that and not judge them. Yeah. Manipulating somebody to, like, put them in a life-risking, life-endangering situation to, like, get them to fall in love with you is probably... Probably not super healthy.
Probably not the best. Okay, yeah. So you and Nick go on this boat ride. We talk. He goes snowboarding with that one girl. How does it actually turn into a relationship?
Basically, I kept on basically not admitting that I was into him. And so my friend's like, he's so cute. I should set him up with my sister-in-law.
Oh, skirt. Your mind was like, ma'am?
Yeah. And so she's like, we've been best friends since grade 5. I now know that she was being very sneaky about this because she knew I would never admit it unless there was like, fire to my feet.
Stop it.
So I was like, she was like, so why don't you, since you're friends with Nick, you reach out to Nick, I'll reach out to my sister-in-law, and then we'll connect them. And I was like, so I can't do that. And she was like, why? And I was like, I think I'm into Nick. And she's like, oh, really? Well, you should text him and ask him on a date. And I was like, okay. So we like sat down and she made me text him before she left.
Wait, so would this make you now the pursuer, even though he was pursuing you before?
In a soft way, but the reality is, like, I was so hot and cold up until that point that I'd never really given a green card for him to, like, take that next step. So I think in that point, like, I was the pursuer, but in every way I was the pursued. Because, like, the only reason I was even at a space where I would, like, be willing to ask him out is because this guy's been pursuing me for, like, 6 months. So it's, like, not really.
Like, did you?
I'm mostly just, like, giving back finally.
So did you, like, literally know, though, girl? Like, did you go to your – who is this, your sister? Who are you just talking to?
My friend.
Your friend.
My friend.
Like, did you ever go to your friend and be like, dude, this guy Nick is, like, going hard on me, bro?
No. She would just be like, oh, it's really interesting. Like, he's, like, suddenly just showed up to church where you always are. And, like, he's always linking. Isn't that interesting? And I'd be like, yeah, like, I think he might be into me. I'm not really sure. I was pretty aware he was into me. I just wasn't sure I was into him.
What changed your mind?
I think I just finally, like, accepted that I wasn't to him a little bit. The only reason I was, like, hesitant about him was his friends, actually. Mm-hmm. He was friends with some, like, pretty unlikable dudes at the time. Like, not – they weren't even bad. They were just, like, obnoxious. Like, really obnoxious and weird and, like, didn't treat women – always the best. Mm-hmm. And so I was like, that weirds me out. Like, I don't know what's going on that, like, this guy that seems really, really nice is friends with people that I find, like, really, really unlikable.
Totally.
And so basically, I think just, like, over time, I, like, started to kind of recognize, like, he tends to be in friendships that he's often, like, very mentory in. And so he'll often be friends with people that, like, he's not very much like, but he's, like, kind of doing life with them and, like, loving on them and, like, challenging some of their ideas. And he's very, like, he's, like, the most infinitely patient person ever. So, like, things that are obnoxious to the rest of us that I miss, like, I'm not gonna be friends with you. I don't want to deal with this. He'll, like, put up with. So I just kind of, like, started to see it as, like, it's probably a strength. And then I think I got to this place of like, it's just dating. Like, we can always break up. Like, yeah. I don't know. Like, why don't I just date him and see?
Yeah.
And I'll see him more away from his friends. Because at that point, I only really saw him around his friends as well. And so I think I just like got over it. And I was like, there's no reason not to just try dating at least. Like,
yeah.
Why am I being such a poo head about this basically?
Well, do you, do you just felt like it was like your own hesitation or baggage, or was it your trauma? Like, what was it?
Probably a little, like a fair bit of my baggage for sure.
Okay.
I'd had some pretty bad relationships with men up until that point. Like, just really, just like weird stuff often happened. Typically my experience with men is they're always attracted to me. Like, they think I'm pretty and then they get to know my personality and then it all falls apart. So, I was just very like dubious of that. I'd had a couple of like really weird experiences. Like, one guy who had like been really obsessive about me and like followed me to like Vancouver and stuff when I went on a trip, but was just like super mean, and he was a friend for a year. And so like when he became super like creepy and mean and rude and terrible, it's just like really, it just really messed with me, I think, for a little while. Kind of spooked me.
Yeah, I don't so, like that. No.
Yeah, there's just like enough creepy stuff that had happened with me and men, or like scary or like uncomfortable stuff, or like men that had just like said really, really horrible things to me, that I was just like, I don't know about this. And Nick kind of seems like a fuckboy. Like, he's just really charismatic. He's really suave. He's very smart. And he had shitty friends who didn't treat women well. And I was just like, something's weird about this situation,
yeah.
You know?
Yeah. Okay, yeah. First of all, I like how you have this like, this horrible like past with men, but then you on our first date told me you were a streamer, basically.
Yeah,
girl, true. You trying to get people stalk you?
That's true. But then they'll look up my socials and they'll be like, "Oh, 10,000? Are you really a streamer?"
I mean, are you though? Yes, you are, girl. You're part sort of it already. You're part of it already. I can feel it. This is gonna be a home for you. I have a feeling. Yeah. Now I'm wondering because. I think it was Destiny or something where they said, I hear a lot from men too, who always say like, "Oh, I'm really nervous. I'm going to do the wrong thing." Like, girls, you do one thing wrong and they just will never talk to you again. And I'm like, yeah, because you're dating. And then I talked to my sister about this. She's like, well, yeah, isn't that what dating is for? It's for us to like literally see one thing and be like, thanks, I'm out. Like, isn't that the point? Versus like when you're in a relationship, you wouldn't do that anymore, obviously, because you're committed. So I wondered, what do you think about that? Do you think people can actually do anything wrong on a date other than the outrageous?
Yes. Like, I think women are way too harsh about this a lot of the time. Like I was reading through a list of reasons why women would not go on a second date. And it was like, some of the reasons were like, his shoes didn't match his belt. And I'm just like, who cares? Or like, he got really weird and awkward and like conversation lulled for a little while. And I'm like, that shit happens. So I think you should be out when there's a big red flag. Like, any red flags, like, especially if you get a huge red flag within 3 dates, I think that's fair to be out, right?
Okay.
Especially for safety reasons, right? But if it's, like, soft yellow flags or just, like anything that's, like, this weird moment where you don't really know what it is, I would just call that, like, that's a yellow flag. Like, unless something's happening where he's making you feel unsafe in any way, if it's a sense of unsafety, just – absolutely. Like, when it comes to women and dating, your safety always has to be priority number one. And his role broadly should be, again, maximizing your agency to ensure that you can maintain that safety. But there's a lot of stuff, like if he does like one weird thing, the reality is like, that doesn't mean anything about his character. Like, when people are nervous and insecure and really into you, they're going to fuck up a lot, because when you're anxious, it brings out the worst of you sometimes. But that doesn't actually mean it's a marker of your character.
Totally.
Sometimes, right, you like make a really like weird kind of like rude joke because you're kind of socially awkward and you thought it would land. You were like trying to lightly tease and the girl's like, oh, that just makes me sad. But that doesn't mean that he's just an asshole. He might just be awkward, right?
And what so like I typically someone who's awkward or anxious.
I guess you can have that line. It's just kind of like, I don't know. It just feels like, I'm like, you can have any preference you want. Just like, be aware. Like, people also get to be like, feel some sort of way about your preferences, right?
Yes.
Like, if I was on a date with a girl and she's like, I just don't like anyone who's awkward or like weird, I'd be like, what does that say about you? Like, that doesn't seem very nice.
Totally.
You know? So usually I say like, look for yellow flags. And then if you have 3 yellow flags of the same behavior and it's a problem to you, I think that's also fine, right? Mm-hmm. So if like he makes really weird kind of cutting jokes 3 times, especially like 3 separate times, and you've like cued multiple times that you like don't appreciate. So he like keeps making jokes about your body that just like don't, they just aren't hitting. They're not funny. They just make you feel like a little sad. Mm-hmm. And that happens three times. That's usually a good indication. Like there might actually be something there. Right. And I think that's fine to like draw the line there. But if it happens once.
For sure. Somebody fuck up. Somebody in the chat says, everyone is awkward sometimes, surely. Yes, yes, yes. But there's always like a spectrum. So like one of the things that jokes, like we always joke about Farm Brothers, like he's an old man. I cannot take this man anywhere because like I talk to everybody, he talks to everybody. So like I have moments when I'm at the store where I'm like, I don't want to talk to anybody. I wear a mask. I'm like, nope. This is the indicator. I don't want to talk to anybody. But my brother, he will literally, like you cannot take, and he'll just talk like a clerk's ear off. And I'm like, they don't want to hear your stories. And he's like, yeah, they do. Look at them. They're happy. I was like, She was happy until the second story. And then she got bored. And he was just like, what? Nobody gets bored of my stories. I was like, I do. And so like, we're all very blunt. And even his wife, she's like, you're so handsome. But then you just talk, talk, talk like an old man at the store. Talk, talk, talk. And so like, we're very open with how we feel about like the things that we joke about. But I noticed that other people also would like, this could be seen as really offensive. Or, like, mean, like, you're bullying people. Like, oh, like, or even my, like, my brothers and I will say things like, you're being really anxious right now. Chill. Let it go. It's just a girl. Let it go. She's just a girl. No big deal. Like, you're going on a date, but it's just, and then we do celebrate, like, dates here. We're like, oh, are you going on a date? And we get, like, really excited. So, I don't know. I just feel like, but see, my family, we're so, it's such a bubble. Like, I can't explain to people, like, this bubble because it's so specific. But we are very, like, blunt when we date. We don't go for too long. And I'm actually... I'm probably the only person in my family who has dated longer than I should have dated people. And they all burned so beautifully that I was like, yes, yes, you were all right. See, that's what I'm saying. In my 20s, I've already done this. I've been so open. So I kind of feel like it's okay for people not to go the other way where you're so strict, you're not even open. But like to get to a point where you know why you're like saying no or why you're choosing the wrong people or why this. Because what I get the fear of is sometimes I'll hear people talk or even what you just said where it's like his boots didn't match his belt or his shoes didn't match his belt. But like I kind of would judge the person on that. But not really. Not like their character. What they prioritize. And then I would judge if they even bothered. Like why'd you even bother wearing a belt and shoes? Just like better to have not worn a belt. Like, you must have thought, I'm going to wear a belt. And the only people I know who wear belts are people who wear slacks. And I don't date people who wear slacks. So I'd also judge them for wearing slacks. No one?
You never date people who wear slacks?
I don't like them. I don't like, the last date I went on, I told the guy, he's like, what do you like? I was like, wear jeans. Because if you wear slacks, I'm going to think you're too good to be on a farm. So he wore jeans.
Fair enough.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, again, you get to have your preferences. I just think, like, it seems arbitrary. Like, a guy wearing slacks on a date... The reality is, like, if he's living on a farm, he's going to learn soon enough to wear jeans anyways, you know? It doesn't really matter if he wears jeans on the date.
The farmers I know go on dates in their best farm clothes, and those are jeans with nice boots and a nice button-down and a nice jacket. Mm-hmm. So when you send – it's a signal, right? It's like, hey, this is the group I'm a part of. If I'm a goth and I'm dating a non-goth, that already is, like, weird to me, but it's possible. So I look at it the same way. Slacks are like being goth to me. Only in my head, slacks are like being business casual, and I'm not a business casual person. I don't chill with that energy. I like those people as friends. But do you get what I'm saying? Like, for me, it's just the same thing where I'm like, yeah, you just look like somebody that we wouldn't shop at the same place. But like the couples I know that I like shop at the same places.
I would just say, like, it feels like an arbitrary standard because the reality is, like, say you're meeting somebody who is in business casual land, but he's super open to being into, like, the farm world as well.
Sure.
Because the non-negotiable here is that you want to live in the country.
Yeah.
It's not slacks, right?
Right. But why would we have slacks in our closet? Like, what would the need even be for what, a wedding?
Because right now he might live in the city, but he's super down to live in the country.
See, that's kind of the problem. I don't trust that because if you're in your 30s and you're not living where you already want to live, I don't trust that.
Maybe, but with inflation, like, I want to live in the country, and I live in a small town, but I want to live, like, rural.
Yeah.
And I just can't. And I probably won't be able to afford it by the time I'm 30. Like, I just won't be able to.
Okay, in America, when you can't afford things, you live in the middle of nowhere. So, like, that's why I live here, because when I want to, but also it's, like, cheap. So it's the opposite.
Yeah, if you're living in a small town, you don't necessarily need to be in jeans.
Yeah, I live in a small town where, like, if anyone showed up in a suit, we'd be like, you think you're better than us? It's like, sends a signal of, like, you think you're better than us.
Yeah. I guess the thing with aesthetic and men is that, like, women think a lot about their aesthetic for the most part. Men broadly don't. And so typically men often wear like what's comfortable and like what vibes with them the most. But you almost always see most men who get married, you see a pretty dynamic shift in their aesthetic as well. So I think like when women are too picky about aesthetic, I'm just kind of like, this is going to change because like most men, their aesthetic seems to mostly represent the broad environment that they're in. And a lot of men are dressed for utility purely. So what's useful when you live in like the city might be slacks, but in the country, it's probably very quickly going to shift to something else because there's going to be more utility.
No, wait.
And so like, that's what I'm saying. Like probably judging on a date, if they wear slacks, they might just be trying to dress to impress. Like they're just trying to put on their nicest clothes.
But this is what I'm saying. So I agree with all of this. I'm saying because I know all of that is true, I have to judge you on wearing slacks. Because I know all of that is true. I want to judge you on who you are. And on a date, you better be presenting me with who you are. Do you know what I'm saying? And if you're not, that's fine. I have no problem with that. But I'm not looking for, that's what I'm saying. I'm saying if you are an individual, because, okay, this is what I'm saying, Kyla. Everyone in the world goes, I want somebody who's truly, like, made for me. But then you all are dating people in such a way that I'm like, why are you even dating? You're making each other miserable. You're fighting every 3 fucking months. Why are you actually dating? You know what I mean? Right. And I'm sitting here and everyone's like looking at me like I'm crazy. But like, again, I'm also the only one who is not yet divorced, thank God. And like, I'm not dealing with like horrible stories from the last 3 years. Like I'm chilling. I've already done it. And I'm saying maybe we can be open to being a little bit more picky. But not where we cut each other off. But you also can't be sad if you're single if you have like a specific standard, like you said.
Right.
You know what I mean? Yes. Look, my closet has only clothes I love. So if I show up on a date, you're going to see me in those clothes. I'm not wearing them for the date. Like, I am wearing them for the date, but I'm wearing them because they're a part of my wardrobe. They represent me.
Yes.
So when I go on a date, I also expect that of my person to be like, hey, tell me who you are. Show up in your best dressed whatever.
Yes, I just don't think most men think about clothes like that.
They think about like best dress, so queer men and then they just do.
Queer men absolutely.
I date queer men. Straight men don't think
like that about clothes.
Right.
They think, what is the archetype of best dressed?
And then
they
put that on. Have you met black straight men? Because they have a sense of fashion.
That's fair. Straight men, I should say, have a sense of fashion. Dominantly white men.
Okay, because like all the people who've dated even like into our family, like the Hispanic part of our like extended family, they all like groom, eyebrows are done, beards are perfect, clothes are nice, colognes, everything.
Right.
So they really care about what they look like. So again, but I'm from California and everybody cares about what they look like.
Yeah, that's fair. Might also be like a bit of a different bubble in that
way. Yes, I am from Cali in that way. So what I'm trying to say is, how do you know like when you're dealing with somebody who's too like... No, that's the wrong question. I just feel like all the advice everyone's giving doesn't matter in the end. Because it's still only trying to get to the date, right? We're not even trying to get them married. We're just trying to teach them how to date. Or people are just trying to get to the date. But like, once you learn how to date and you learn how easy it is, then you're still going to have to figure out how to actually find a partner that's compatible with you.
Yeah. And like the more narrow your preferences are, you also have to make sure that like people who are within your preference that you've narrowed it to are actually going to be interested back in you, right? Because a lot of people set a really small margin of what they're interested in, but also they don't really offer any of those people something that they'd necessarily be interested in return, right? Totally. Like it's possible that like open-minded people would be like, I'm not really okay with you being judgmental about slacks. Like that to me is weird, you know? That to
me it's not a judgment. It's not a judgment. Yeah. It's only a judgment in relation to dating me. So, like, again, it has nothing to do with anyone. All of my statements have never anything to do with what people are doing in general. I don't care. It's always only in relation to me. So, like, I have a preference. Like, because, like, when I hear, like, in LA, like, the guys who wear slacks and, like, button downs, they also drive, like, Lamborghinis. If I ever date anyone who spent money on a Lamborghini, I would be like, what is this? Even if we had an excess of money. Because I just don't value these things. And I really do want to date someone who's like me. So we're doing the same things, basically. But that's the thing, right? Is I think a lot of people like to date their opposites, maybe. Or maybe people who differ from them. What do you think about that?
I definitely think that you should be more similar than different. Distinctly, though, I would say, like, personality-wise. I think, like, probably the best matches are made mostly by personality. Which is why I think, like, I agree. Aesthetic can map on to personality.
Totally does.
But I think depending on the individual, it does to more or less of an extent, distinctly based on like what their cultural backgrounds are around aesthetic specifically. And so this is why, like, I'm always careful with women when we're talking about, like, especially if they're talking about dominantly men, is being like, well, we have to think about aesthetic for men, but then also, like, within subcultures of men as well, right? Of, like, what it actually means before we're, like, making certain, like, judgments. Because what you're really looking for is somebody whose personality is similar to you, like, right. Similar enough.
Right.
Right? Because that seems to be what makes relationships work the best long term. And then beyond that, relationships mostly work because two people decide to make it work. And are willing to make it work, right? That's like the next step is like, you're not going to find your perfect match. There probably doesn't really exist. Like every now and then your perfect match might exist, but perfect matches are both selected and probably made. It's probably a combination of these two things.
I like that idea of like selected and made a little bit. I don't know. I like the couples that I look at and I go, okay, they're perfect for each other. They didn't settle. They both ended up with partners that were great. There are also people that like dress similarly, have the same job areas, like to live in the same area. Like they have insane amount in common. They do disagree on like politics sometimes, which is funny. Or they'll disagree on like how to go about doing things, mostly because they're men and women. And that's great, right? Like I think that's wonderful. But I guess I'm just like, I think I'm in a world that we know everything is a construct. I'm surprised that we are not aware that we are also constructing how we date and how we fall in love. And we get to pick and choose the rules.
And we do. I think we actually do. I just think people are putting too much emphasis on things that don't actually select well for partnerships, right? Nick and I are not well matched in any other metric but personality.
Oh.
Like in every way, people would say that I very much so settled because when I met him, he didn't have a high school diploma. Mm-hmm. He was a high school dropout. He didn't have a license and he worked minimum wage at a homeless shelter. I was a like pretty top end academic student. I was doing research. I had a lot of future academic prospects. I was dominantly middle class and I was working mostly higher paying like middle class student jobs.
Right.
So we were worlds apart. Our aesthetics were very different in almost every way, but our personalities were very similar and our values were very similar, which is like why we worked. And I would say like, in no way did I date down like at all, even though from like a lot of metrics of like earning, for example, like I was way outpacing him educationally and like just financially.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think the problem is that I am concerned distinctly that women are placing emphasis on things that in a modern world don't matter as much anymore for like relationship happiness. Now you can do whatever you want in dating. I don't care. Like I think you can do whatever, just so it's clear. I'm just saying, this is what I think I see works best. I could be wrong and it might not apply to you, but this is what I think broadly is going to be predictive of better relationships. Isn't that what
I'm saying? Am I saying something different from you?
Mostly I think I'm just disagreeing about like, but I don't care about clothes.
Clothes are, for me, they are your personality. It might be the gay in me. Sometimes. It might be the gay in me though.
Yeah,
like
potentially.
Because like
clothes is your personality.
Yes,
for like, sure. Yeah, like your clothes. Yeah, for me, it's not actually.
Fair. That makes sense. Yeah, because even all my siblings, we all dress specific to ourselves. Like my mom knows. We all know whose clothes are whose because we all have a very distinct. We're very closer. I don't know what it is. Maybe it's genetics. Because even my 3-year-old nephew, he already like all of them dress themselves, and they're like, "Do not tell me how to dress. I know how to match my clothes." Like they're we show through our expression, like. Our clothes, our hair, how we groom our hair. We're all like, oh, we're going for this look today. Like, it's very important to us. Actually, when I do see people who put no effort in how they dress or look, I'm like, what's happening here? But then, of course, like, people look at me and think the same thing because I go for more casual, like, a guy in sweats. That's my shit right there. A girl in sweats. I'm like, fuck the slacks, sweats, but a nice pair of sweats that match, or maybe even like Teddy Fresh or something recognizable. Not because I like brands, but because I like the energy of Teddy Fresh. I'm like, ah, vibing. So it's not like I'm saying slacks are bad. I'm saying, oh, you're signaling to me you like dress in city wear. Tell me about that.
Yes. And I agree with that. I'm just saying that I don't think all groups, all like subcultures, particularly within our dating lens, view aesthetic in that way. Which if, for example, when I talk with men, that's one of the things I talk about is your aesthetic is communicating something at all times. Right. But a lot of men, again, people are getting really mad about like stereotypes. Of course we're stereotyping. We're talking about general groups. This is obviously not true for every single man and every single subculture, but a lot of men, when they think about aesthetic, They don't. They think about clothing as a piece of utility, right? Am I wearing the clothes to get be comfortable and get the job done, right? If I'm doing labor type work, I'm going to wear clothes that appeal to doing labor. So it's going to be thicker threads that don't tear as easily and have like higher safety measures, yes. And are comfortable enough that I can be sweating in them for 12 hours and not get like chafed, right? But when you're going out on a date, the reality is that your aesthetic is communicating something about you. And so I think a lot of men will just opt for, I want to communicate that I am put together. So they'll just like wear whatever they view as like their nicest clothes. And what their nicest clothes are is going to be, of course, mostly culturally informed, right? but they're not actually thinking, does this nice outfit tell the person something about me that's true about me? And it may or may not, right? And so I think I try to hold space for that, especially because I know with my aesthetic, I mostly think about aesthetic from a utility standpoint, and I'm only starting to realize like utility, part of the utility is communicating to others something about you.
But wait,
right? And I just never thought of that.
Okay, but wait, that's what I'm saying. No one's doing anything wrong. I'm saying if you dress for utility, that is you telling me what you dress for.
Right, which but most men don't even think of that. They don't think of that. They're just like, I'm just wearing this because it's comfy.
Abba and Destiny both do this, and I think they're lying out of their asses. Abba goes, I don't even care what I look like, bro. I'm wearing this sweater from high school. I'm like, that is an aesthetic. I'm the cool guy who doesn't spend money on clothes. And he goes like this. Yes. He goes, oh, I'm wearing this t-shirt because it was from a sponsor, but it's not even sponsored. I just wanted to grab whatever I had. Yes, Abba, we all have clothes in our closet that we get for free from Disney or some shit. Why are you acting like you're in Destiny?
I wholly agree
with you. He goes, I don't care what I look like. Sir, you dress very specifically. If my father saw you, he'd know exactly what kind of a man you were. Please, they're not dressing neutral. The image is that, oh, we don't care what we look like. Please. Especially Abba, he cares what he look like. This man does his hair. He says he doesn't. In the same way I say I don't. I also don't care what I look like.
Right. Yes. I agree with you. I wholly agree with you. And some people are saying that I don't realize that men care about how they look. Men do care about how they look. They don't think about aesthetic as a lot of people think about aesthetic as just being like, I'm vapid. And it's like, that's not what aesthetic is. And it never has been. It never has been ever historically. Aesthetic has always meant something. And it always does. Even if your aesthetic is, I'm a chill guy who don't care what I look like, it's still an aesthetic, right? But this is what I'm saying. A lot of people don't see that or agree with that or like recognize that. Mm. And so a lot of things for men or anyone, to be honest, for dating is, what is your aesthetic communicating about you? And do you think that is true? And do you want it to be communicating that thing? Because if you want to be communicating, I'm a guy who doesn't care about much and I'm super chill and I'm kind of a gamer dude, that's fine. Is that what you want to be communicating? Or is there more to you? Do you want to also be like, yeah, I'm a gamer dude, but I'm also pretty put together? Well, then there's a different aesthetic that we can like drive from that. And so like a lot of people, it feels like they kind of stumble into their aesthetic just because like probably their personality selects for it. But there's also an intentionality that you can put on top of that, right? Of being like, you know, like for example, like I really like chokers because I like chokers both in that they're like sexy. Me and my chat always choke that I have the Church of Chokers now.
Cute.
We're starting a priesthood if you'd ever like to join.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Right. I like chokers for a bunch of reasons. Number one, I have a decently long neck and a strong jawline, and the choker emphasizes that because it sets a base point for my neck. So it just elongates my neck. So it looks good, but also it communicates a certain level of like sexuality. That I, for whatever reason, people don't read a ton of sexuality from me. So I like to add a choker to like imbue that a little bit of being like, no, I am a sexual being and I'm more comfortable actually in that space.
Yeah.
Right. And so there's just like different things that I'm both selecting because I like it and then also being intentional. And like aesthetics should ideally be a bit of both of these things. They don't have to, obviously, but when you're dating, it's inherently communicating both of these things, whether you like it or not.
Interesting. I do. Okay, I'm thinking about those tech guys I knew in Seattle who I would describe their sense of dress as bland and unforgettable. And the reason I say that, I'm like, you just look like you went to the khaki section of the khaki store and went, khaki, I'm going to buy this khaki. And I went, why? And they would probably be like, oh, I just want to be comfortable. I'm like, I am also comfortable, pockets. But I'm in like fashion comfortable. So wait, what did you say just now?
It's pockets. I know khaki guys. It's pockets.
Yes, it's because it's of the utility.
Yeah, yes. And they're full. There's like calculators and notepads in them probably. Yeah, I'm friends with khaki guys.
I am not. Yeah. I am about it for my friends. I love that for them so much. But how am I supposed to get wet to that?
Right.
is my question. Now, that's only because, again, and I am queer and I used to be poor. And so in my head, I was like, man, I can't wait till I have money to actually dress my aesthetic. Because in my head, I never could even afford it. I had hand-me-down clothes until I was like 18. Like I couldn't afford, you know, I didn't have those choices. And of course, I grew up in a home that didn't let me dress the way I wanted to. And so now I'm dressing the way I want to. But it's like, and all of it has different themes. Like today, I wanted to be like hugged again. So I was like, perfect. I'll wear a long sleeve turtleneck. It feels like I'm being embraced. I'm wearing like a jumpsuit. So it's also on how I feel. But I am trying to communicate also power. I didn't want to show off too much titty today. I want to show off more like executive Brittany or like top Brittany. So it's like in different, not sexy top Brittany, but like executive, like in here for business. So that's what I'm saying. Like, I am okay that people don't think about these things, but isn't them not thinking about it also a judgment of compatibility, probability?
Sorry, say that again.
Isn't them not taking into consideration their aesthetic literally a compatibility issue for some people like me?
No, because I think it's pretty easy. I think no, because I basically think in a lot of subcultures, it's absolutely socialized into men to not think about aesthetic because it's viewed as basically like effeminate to think about it, or like usually it's some form of effeminate. Kyla,
so they just teach men not to think about it. I wouldn't date someone like that. I wouldn't date someone who was raised in that bubble, and I wouldn't date someone who hadn't gotten out of that bubble.
I guess it makes me sad for all the guys where like there's so many guys that I talk to who the moment I just say this, they're like, oh. And they immediately start caring about their aesthetic. There's so many people in my Discord that literally never thought about it till we had this conversation. Yeah. And they're like, oh, and it immediately swapped. And so I'm just like, you might be missing out on so many people that just, if you just said that, they'd be like, oh, and it would just be different after that. It was just like, they don't know that they don't know.
No, no, no. They are missing out to be with me because I need someone who's self-aware, not someone who goes, oh, aesthetic. And I'm like, duh. Like,
that's fair.
You know what I'm saying? So, like, that's the problem, too. I'm in my 30s, so I'm not going to be the dating age for most people, I think. Mm-hmm. So that's the other thing, too. When I orchestrate – because I did it all through my 20s, like, just nonstop through my 20s. And then I've only been single the last 3 years. And so much of what I've learned about me is that I do know what I want, but because I heard this feedback from people, I dated people I wasn't compatible with and wasn't even attracted to begin with. But because people were like, be open, give them a chance – it led to the most outrageous breakups of my life over and over again. And so I decided, you know what? I'm just going to go back to my picky self that I was before. And I've never been happier because I never come home to a fucking toxic relationship. I never come home to somebody that I'm like, why did you do this? Like, why did you make this decision? Right? Mm-hmm. So I'm saying I want to give people relief too on my end that it's okay to be single because like, honestly, do you really want to come home to a shitty relationship? But also, why do you want a relationship so much? Like people in the comments are like, wow, her ego, she's so specific. She's so, yes, guys, 100%. Because I think this is it. Like my like belief that this is the one true, like the one life we have is forcing me to live life every day how I want with no compromise if compromise means values. You know what I mean? Mm. Like people always say things to me like, Brittany, like I'm perfect. Like come to the city and date me. I'm like, do you want my mental health to go back into the gutter?
Right.
Like I also am sick. So maybe I don't get the luxury of having as much openness.
I was going to say, I think there's probably something distinct here going on in that like probably people with certain like mental health factors that like personality disorders and stuff like that. Mm. There is a higher level of pickiness that is required.
Yes.
Same with like somebody with like addiction, right? Like somebody in addiction, they might have to be really, 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 really overly stringent about certain things. And the reality is like, you just get to be picky. I don't know.
Yes,
like
girl. You can. Yes, girl.
And you're also okay with people feeling some sort of way about it and knowing that means that it's going to like turn people off, which is also fine. Like,
which is perfect. That's what I wanted to do.
When it comes to preferences, like, I don't care what people have. Like, you can have whatever you want. And like, if my prescriptions work for you, based. And if they're helpful, based.
Yes.
If they don't work for you, that's also fine. Like,
this is reality.
Some relationships are never going to be in the box that I'm describing at all.
Yes.
All I'm trying to tell you is the box that we do know exists. And descriptively, most of us exist within it. But you might be outside of it. And that's fucking based. And then there's nothing I can tell you because you're going to be broadly without it. And that's
okay. Here's my concern. What do you do with these guys when you give them advice or anyone in this category? And they go, all I have to do is this and I'll have a wife. But then they do all the things they're supposed to and still no wife.
I would say probably you're misunderstanding what I'm doing. I'm not saying that if you do all this, you'll get a wife.
Ah,
that's not guaranteed. What I'm saying is
go ahead.
You are going to have better access and better chances at finding somebody, because there are certain things that you broadly should probably improve on to be better at dating.
Okay, that, yes, I agree with that. So I guess my concern, because I deal with a lot of people at the end of that who have gone, who know who they are, love themselves, and they're like, so why am I single? I'm like, oh, because now we have to have the consent conversation about cohabitation. Right. So maybe that's the issue too. So when I'm seeing people give dating advice, I'm like, okay, this is great for right now. What happens when they do all those things and they figure out who they are and they love themselves and they go to therapy and they have money and they're in good shape and they're still single? Does that mean there's still something wrong with them? Probably not. It probably just means you're not meeting the person that you genuinely are willing to marry. Like, I know how, you know how it's like normal for men's spheres to be like, I'm not getting married, divorce and alimony is insane in courts. So they're allowed to stay single. But a woman who says she's staying single because she wants the perfect guy is delusional.
Yeah, I mean, part of the issue is that there's two different reasons there. The woman staying single because she's got, like, basically what they would view as super, super, super high levels of standards that are unrealistic. The guy is not marrying because he is afraid of the eventual effects of the outfall.
Well, isn't the woman afraid of
fucking him over?
But isn't the woman afraid of ending up with a man she doesn't love because he's not the man of her dreams?
Yes, and then people basically say, are you sure that those are the things that are actually going to make you fall in love with somebody? Which I think is a valid critique. Like, I do think there are some things as like that people said as non-negotiables that probably aren't making them happier. And maybe they're like, no, it is making me happier. And that's fine.
Yeah.
But if it's not making you happier, it's worth looking at, right? And a lot of the people who are like, who have these really high expectations, and like a lot of the women specifically that we're talking about, are also deeply unhappy, and they're not happy being single, and they're wondering why nothing's ever changing, right? And it's like, well,
yes,
you've probably got some non-negotiables here that you don't actually need, and they aren't going to actually make you that happy. Right?
Are we
a lot of women would say 6 foot height is a non-negotiable. It's like, it's probably not going to make you happy.
So that's the thing. So I don't have things like that. I don't care about height. I don't care about I don't care about things you can't change.
Right.
So what do I care what you can't change, right? I don't care if my partner has mental illnesses or even STIs. I don't care if my partner has a lot of things. I don't care if my partner wants to see other people. I don't care about a lot of things that other people care about. But I do care about us having similar lifestyles. Like, again, I don't want to date a girl who's like, I need to have makeup on to leave the house. I'm like, what is this? You're stopping our whole life to put on some mascara? Absolutely not. Get out the house, girl. Let's go. And some people are like, that's crazy, Brittany. Like, well, she wants to wear makeup, let her wear makeup. I never said not to wear makeup. I said, it's your choice. Just same with video games. I don't want someone who's on video games 24/7. It will drive me literally up the wall.
Right.
Because that's not my life. So even with the slacks, which sounds shallow, but is actually trying to say what your lifestyle is. Like my mom would say, Betsy, if she wears a low-cut top, that's not the same girl as the Midwest homeschool girl who's a Christian and goes to church. You're not going to find a Midwest girl who goes to church every day who wears low-cut tops and is on OnlyFans. Right. So then these arbitrary things that are shallow in some ways are extremely insightful in others.
As long as the aesthetic that they're showing you is actually representative of their identity, because sometimes people put on aesthetics specifically for dates that aren't a representation of their identity. They're just trying to look nice, right? And so that's the main trick you get into is why I typically say three, right? If they're wearing clothes three times that communicate to you, I'd say that's probably a better rule of thumb than just the first time they don't have a belt and shoes matching. And maybe they thought the brown was close enough to the black that they're like, they probably won't notice. And it just sucks because when you're in different light, it's really glaringly obvious, you know?
But wouldn't you want a girl to reject you for something so stupid like that so you don't date her because she's shallow like that?
I think for men, it's frustrating because it sucks to get rejected over something that seems so trivial. And it's like, well, you never gave me a shot. Because a lot of men
I
would
feel like
do that
people
as,
don't deserve to be dating. I'm sorry.
Book cover.
I don't understand any of this at all. Because a part of me is again, are we dating as 19-year-olds? Or are we dating as 30-year-olds?
So that's the thing. Most people are dating as young, between 19 to 20. I would also agree that once you're getting over 30, the dating really changes.
Okay, then that's fair. Then none of this, this is... Because at 19, guys, I mean, at 19 I was so open to anything. Of course I would have been open to not anything. A person being different from me, a person not even having my values, not even sharing my reality. But as I've gotten older and dated all these people, I've now realized none of it worked because of these reasons from my understanding. So, okay. Right. So then we need to talk about that. We need to talk about dating younger and then dating older because it's very different. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay. It's very different.
It is really different. Again, this is where we're getting. So when we're dating, so a lot of issues that people are going to have, for example, with the slacks thing, if we just go back to that, because that's the common thing that we've been talking about. Mm-hmm. A lot of people get frustrated when a heuristic is placed against them, right? Mm-hmm. It's the reason why, for example, I say like, I don't even like to call myself a Christian because I know what heuristic gets attached mm-hmm. to that. And it really doesn't identify me well, right? Mm-hmm. And so when people are like, my heuristic is telling me that slacks mean this about you. And then they'd be like, what the fuck, man? I was just trying to wear nice pants for you. Great. You know, it doesn't mean any of that about me.
Does this change if I ask them that on the date? Cause I would, I am that person. Like, what do you think
slacks? That's true. You would definitely ask them about it. I think it does change. Right.
Cool. Cause that's why I also,
a lot of people hear this and think you're making these assumptions implicitly. No, it never gets talked about. And then you walk away and they're like, are you telling me I got dumped and ghosted because I had slacks on? No. I have no idea.
No. I would 100% ask. Like, I ask about everything. No. So that's something I forget too. I am literally, it's a job. Like, you are there to ask if you can be a part of Brittany's life. You had best believe I'm going to ask every detail. Why'd you choose that color? Why'd you choose these slacks? Why'd you choose this material? Did you think about it being cotton? Because, like, I love cotton. I love it for this reason. Do you like it for this reason? Do you like this kind of – you know what I'm saying? So, yes. So, for the record, for everyone listening, I would never make the assumption and trust my assumption. I would ask if my assumption was correct.
And so that's what's unique about you compared to most people in dating is a lot of people won't ask. They'll make an assumption. They'll apply a heuristic, and you'll get basically, you'll get rejected over something that's not even true about you based on a heuristic that was never asked. So that's going to be people's frustration when they hear, if I see slacks, I'm over it, is they hear making a heuristical assessment about me. You know nothing about me. It might not even be true. And it seems really shallow and vain. And now I know that I'm getting rejected over something that has nothing to do with me, which sucks, right? Getting rejected over something you did is one thing. Getting rejected over something you didn't even do is way worse because you're like, now I can't win because I'm going to get rejected for shit I didn't even do, you know?
I just feel like it says more about them than me. Like, I never, when I'm getting rejected, I'm like, okay, cool. Thanks. Let me, like, you're just saying I don't like your flavor of ice cream. They're not saying they don't like you. And even if they are, fuck them.
That's fair. I think when you're more insecure, that's harder.
Yeah. That's fair. That's fair. And don't get me wrong. It's not like I don't sit at home and think, did I text too much? Did I like overly text? Oh my gosh, are they going to think I'm manic? You know what? Fuck it. Because I can't do anything about that. Because even when I'm not manic, people think I'm manic if they don't know what mania is. So like in some ways, I need them to say what they think I'm doing. So I go, oh, you don't even know how to see me. Because I think seeing people is a skill as well. But wait, if you know, so we're having this conversation, right? We're like talking about all the like little secrets. Okay, so people... Mm-hmm. So if you know girls are going to judge you on what you wear, then why wouldn't you dress as yourself so they can judge you on that? And why would you dress differently from who you are in every day?
I think – so this is because you're assuming – I think there's a problem in that. Like I think when you go through life as Brittany, you think about everything all the time. You're almost never in – I don't think you're in automaton mode almost ever.
What is that?
Like automated mode. Like you're just going through life and not thinking about it.
I have been in the past, obviously. I have a whole journeys in my levels video. But like, no. Like now, of course, no.
Most people are going through life and they're not really thinking about things. They'll kind of post-hoc think about things sometimes, right? So like when somebody's going on a date, I don't think a lot of them are even thinking like, she's going to judge me based on my aesthetic, so I'm going to wear this. Some people think like that. Most people just think, I'm going to try to look nice. And then they just like think, what does culture say looks nice? And then they throw that on, right? That's mostly, I think, how people operate, right? And
but then they're giving advice. That's what I'm saying. They're seeking out advice. So why wouldn't the advice be dress as yourself because she's going to judge you on your clothes? Why is the advice women stop judging men on their clothes? Why isn't the advice because men dressed better?
So typically the advice that I communicate to men, for example, is like obviously like dress is a way that communicates something about yourself to people, but you can communicate that in a way that looks aesthetically pleasing and you can communicate that in a way that does not look aesthetically pleasing. And we should choose the aesthetically pleasing option because people like to look at things that look good, right? So like you can communicate, I'm really into tech in a way that both feels like you and also looks nice, right? Colors that match, just even selection of colors alone is a huge part of this, right? Like if you pick a color, for example, like I look really bad in like silver and like yellow gold jewelry, like a soft gold or like a rose gold typically looks best with me, right? But I can wear the same necklace. I could wear this in silver. It's still kind of communicating the same thing, but I've selected the most aesthetically pleasing version of it for myself. Yeah. Right. My hair, I tend to like my hair in natural colors. Right. However, I've got like an ombre. So that's not my natural hair, but it's still natural looking, but it's like the most aesthetically pleasing version of it. Right. So there's like, there's always variation within you, or you can choose a version that looks also better, because part of you is also like dressed to what makes you look nice. Like everyone's got a different body type. Certain dresses that look really good on me, even though I might say like, that's so within my aesthetic, the reality is my body can't give that as like, it just doesn't work.
Totally.
Yeah.
It's so weird. So like, there's a way we talk about this that sounds like really LA shallow, but isn't. I went on a date with a guy and I made him stand next to me in a mirror. I was like, I want to see if we look good together. He's like, what do you mean? I was like, I don't know. You just got a vibe from couples. Like you see them and you're like, yeah, they belong together. I just want to see if we get that feeling. So we looked at each other and I was like, almost. It almost looks really good, but I don't think it looks really good. And it's not because neither of us were like unattractive. It's not like that. It's not like LA judging like, oh, we're not hot enough. It's like, do we look like we belong together? And like that, Matt, like, again, that's intuitive, more feeling, more energy. Cause I meet those couples and I'm like, oh my God, you guys so have the energy of you need to be good. Like you need to be together. You know what I mean? Right. Like I'm looking for any hint I have to go in the proper direction. Right. And so for me, like authenticity is like really big, but also being strategic with, cause like I know how to socialize. Okay. I'm not totally inept. But I also know that, like, I am arrogant. And so, like, my joy has to be first. Because I'm the only one living my life. So, like, I won't say.
What do you mean when you say I am arrogant?
Arrogance to me is, like, an kind of, like, overconfident.
Okay. Like, you think you're an overconfident person?
Yeah. Okay. I probably, well, because I'm an exaggerator. So, I upsell a lot, but I also exaggerate when I tell stories. I exaggerate. Even that's an exaggeration because I'm arrogant and confident, like a Slytherin, but I also like hold obviously a lot of humility because like otherwise, like how could I function if I didn't? But I want people to know that like, because gosh, it's just a specific kind of arrogance. Like my farm brother has it worse than I do. And we always joke we might be the most arrogant people on this planet. But it's very, people are attracted to us. Like we are not without, that's what I'm saying. We're not sitting here not being hit on. So you can't even tell me, like, when people are like, don't be so arrogant, it's unattractive, tell that to my DMs. You know what I mean? And at the same time, I'm also not finding my partner, so maybe I should be less arrogant. But I can't be, girl. It's just who I is. It's not going to happen. This is the happiest. So the point is I want to encourage people to always be their joyous, whether they're partnered or not. But I keep hearing from everyone, regardless of your joy, be appealing to people. That's what I keep hearing.
Do you think who you are is fixed, or do you think it like changes over time? Like when people say like, I am who I am, that usually says to me like, I am who I am and it doesn't change. And it's kind of like, it's the solidified thing. I'm curious what you think about that.
I think people have like final forms, but I think that form, like I think I am in my final form, but I don't think I'm in my final Brittany. So I'm not going to probably like change tomorrow and get a bunch of tattoos and split my tongue. But like 4 or 5 years ago, that was an option for me. I was like, do I want to be a split tongue girl? Or do I want to be this girl? Do I want to be this one? So I think I found the final form I'm going to be in, like in terms of aesthetic and everything, because I tried all kinds. But I think I will always grow as a person, not a personality. This is my personality since I was born, my mom says. I believe her. But like it is going to, I'm always going to be, it's like Goku or Vegeta or Cell. I don't know if you watch Dragon Ball Z or anime. But like.
No, not Dragon Ball Z.
Okay, I wanted to use a Dragon Ball. Okay, I'm going to use a Dragon Ball Z reference. You should get it. Goku's like one of the best fighters in the world, but there's always going to be someone who's stronger. He's never going to stop training to be the next best strongest. He wants to be the strongest. But he can't he can't train to be the strongest without knowing there's someone stronger out there waiting to meet him, right? So I know that I'm not perfect Brittany, and I know I'll always be gaining to be the strongest, better Brittany, but I also know that I'm this Brittany. Like, Goku is Goku through the whole series. Like, he doesn't change, but he changes. That's how I see myself. I'm not going to change, but I'm going to change.
Right.
Right? Okay. Versus some people in past Brittany, she changed aesthetic, how she looked, what job she wanted, where she wanted to live. Like, almost like she was different people.
Right.
Trying to figure out her real version. So does that answer your question?
Yeah, no. Yeah, it makes sense, right? Because this is kind of what I'm trying to understand about you is I know like for borderline, it causes you to have a really unstable sense of self, right? That's like one of the hallmarks of it. And so I was curious about that because when you're talking about like, I am who I am, it's very antithetical to borderline of like, I don't know who I am. Like, fuck. Well, you know, that's part of the issue.
I remember not having borderline and then I remember having borderline. Because my childhood trauma didn't happen until I was a little older. So I remember a Brittany from 3 years old, 4, 5, 6, 7, that existed. And she, my mom even says it. She's like, Brittany, you have always just been Brittany. Like, I came out of this womb and I was like, I am me. Listen to me. Then from 8 years old all the way to like 28, 30, I was in a spiral of identity. Who am I? What am I doing? What does this mean? I am literally like guaranteed triggered. It's all over queer stuff. Like, I know I'm like straight presenting. I know that a lot of people don't know that I'm queer. I know I date men. So, and I have dated women, obviously, but when people see me with a man, but all my borderline stuff, my therapist is like so confident it all stems from the gayness. And it's the only thing now that triggers me currently. So I'm 3 years like free of triggers or episodes, but I had a, what I call a mini trigger. And I have to specify it because my brain works differently, but like my mom knows how to do it. Once my mom says to me, like, Betsy, you're not gay. Were you molested? You're not gay. You must be something else. My brain disassociates. And I'm like, stop disassociating. Go back into your body. It's fine. You know what I mean? So for me, of course, I'm being told my whole life, this isn't who you are. This isn't who you are. Mm-hmm. So I've had to spend my whole life like, no, I'm pretty sure this is who I am. And even now, people are doing it to me right now. Brittany, this isn't who you are. This isn't how you want to date. This isn't how what kind of a man or woman you want. And I'm like, I know myself well enough. And instead of feeling insecure about it, I'm just going to be like, nope, I'm going towards my joy. And my joy is leading me in this direction. So I am arrogant because I figured out something that the whole world is claiming they haven't figured out. And I might be the only schmuck who did it. But I only did it because I did it for me and no one else. I don't think about my community when I think about my joy.
I don't think about my community when I think about my joy.
My as personal in like, joy. My inner
joy. Your joy is from within.
Yes. Like when I am existing by myself, I can only think about Brittany's joy. And that is what keeps me going. You know what I mean?
Interesting. When you're saying my queerness is my trigger, I've just never heard that with borderline. Do you, you obviously anything you don't want to answer, say no to. I'm just, that just piques my interest. I've never heard that with borderline specifically.
Yeah. What, do you mean like the, like, cause people usually ask like, oh, you have borderline. So like, were you like the traditional reasons people have borderline?
Well, you were saying like between 8 and like 30, you're in like this spiral and it, you said it was, and it was really connected to my queerness.
Yes.
And I'm just not understanding. Oh, I'm not seeing those two connected.
So I was raised in a really loud and confrontational home where we shared our feelings and like what we thought about things. And so I grew up internalizing and hearing like gay people are bad and they're evil. They're pedophiles. They're molesters. They're going to hell. We have to keep our kids from being gay. This is like really important. And then when I was younger, my mom like pinned on me and she was like, are you gay? And I was like, whoa, I'm like young. And I was like, I don't know what this means. And then eventually I was like, oh, is she asking me if I like my friends? And then I would think about it. And then, yeah, once I realized, like, yeah, I do like my friends all the same, like the boys and the girls. I'm interested in holding hands with both of them. And then I got introduced to liberal friends who introduced me to the idea of gayness outside of conservatism. And that led me down a path of realizing, like, oh, my God, I have to kill myself later because I can't be gay because gays are pedophiles and gays are molesters and gays are evil. And my parents are never going to love gay people and they're afraid of gay people. And I'm the thing and they don't know yet. But my mom did know because she's been asking me since I was a kid. Same with my other gay siblings. She knows right away. She sees her kid. She's like, this one's gay. And I'm like, what? But then she doesn't, you know what I mean? So my therapist thinks my borderline started by me pre-abandoning myself because of what I was consuming and hearing in my home, which led me to thinking of myself as conservative Brittany and also gay Brittany as being something that wasn't important and I could shove down.
Okay. Okay. So it was like the repression because like your queer identity was never – not just not like okay in your family, but like distinctly bad within like your family values.
100%. Like to the point where they would tell a story about gay people in Iraq and the only gay people that existed were people that were like ostracized and pedophiles. Or in the States when I was in high school, I was a part of the first GSA club and my mom was one of the protesters outside the school trying to shut it down. I had to come out not as like gay, but as like an ally. When I did come out, my cousin outed me and then told everyone I molested her and then took it back 10 years later and said, I never said that. And I was like, oh my. So it was like everything associated with my gayness has been hell on earth. Just like the worst thing ever. And then my brother came out as gay and that was a big deal and I got blamed for it. Then my sister came out and then I got blamed for it. And so like, yeah, everything associated. And then I am gay. And then of course it doesn't help that like the world Like, I know what I am and I know what I like, but I didn't know how to be okay being that person and being a person that didn't have to hate, like, conservatives or didn't have to ostracize myself from this community that I loved. So once again, I had to do the work, humble brag, of making all these people understand that I love them regardless. But that means, once again, I'm the person who is taking on the burden of healing everyone's trauma and making myself accessible to people. So, like, yeah, I've had issues with gay things my whole life, like, my dad didn't talk to me for 3 years as a teenager because I was reading a gay book and I rebelled. And so for like 3 years, I had to say good morning, dad, and good night, dad, every day. And he didn't say a word to me. Mm-hmm. We're very stubborn people. And we moved past that and we got over it. But it is like very hard. And then I came out at 21 again and that traumatized my parents again. And then I dated a girl and that traumatized them again, which traumatized me. So yeah, my borderline is like, I've had to work really hard, which is why I like tropes and I like characters. So I say, like, who are you most like? Which I think is why also people think I'm autistic a little bit, because I'm like, well, what are you, angry or sad? And like my, because then my job though, Kyla, here's the trick. My job is telling people what they're lying about to me. So when people do calls with me, I have to see their face. So I can say, I know you're saying this, but I actually think this is what you're trying to tell me. And then I'm usually like, don't let me project. Am I correct? And they'll be like, holy shit, you are right. Yeah, I am doing that. So funny enough, because I had to be so into my own self and dissecting me, it made me really good at doing my job today. Which is why I feel pretty lucky about the way my life went. Because like, holy shit, if I wasn't so traumatized, I wouldn't be good at my job.
Okay, I'm understanding. So like when you're talking about borderline, like some of the main traumas that were like triggering a large part of it was your queer identity.
Oh yeah. Okay. Mm-hmm. And then like, okay. Yeah. And being queer in a Middle Eastern culture, you're not just losing like your direct family, like all my cousins, my grandparents, like,
yes,
there was a lot of group conversations about where was Brittany allowed.
Yeah. Okay.
Was she allowed at family gatherings? Can we let Brittany around kids? When my cousin let me babysit her kids after I came out, I cried. Cause I was like, I was so afraid he would think I was going to molest them. She's like, Brittany, I'm not that kind of Middle Eastern person. I know gay people exist and they're not molesters. But that was not something I grew up hearing. So in my bubble, yeah, I was like, oh, it was perfect, like a perfect storm for borderline, which is sort of like ironic, like in a lot of ways. But yeah, so I think I've been, that's what I'm saying. I have been forced to live off script because none of the scripts fit me.
Yes.
So I guess I'm always like, I guess my channel has always been centered around alternative people to help like people who feel not a part of the script. So I think it's interesting when we observe you guys for sure. Cause I'm not the only one too. My audience is also like, why are they all talking this way? And I'm like, because it's their bubble. But then we're wondering like, why, how do you feel like, because I think you're so open and so cool. And I think like being a script person is fine, but like, you also don't feel like one to me sometimes.
Yeah. I think I definitely don't fully occupy within it, but I think, I'm kind of like joke, like I'm in normie, in like real normie land, like people who I would say like non-internet people land, I'm really fucking weird. Like really weird in that like they don't consider me part of their group.
Yeah.
Like I'm quirky enough that I'm considered an outsider. But in internet land, I'm also not so like, I don't know, I guess like quirky that I don't feel like I'm fully accepted. It's like people think I'm a normie. And I'm like, guys, normies don't accept me. Like yeah. Y'all are so like... I'm telling you, I'm outside of that. So I think I'm a little bit in between. I'm in limbo a little bit, but I can kind of LARP in either direction I like want to.
Do you see a bubble on YouTube like you really like and maybe want to be a part of? Like, have you made a decision? Because you got kind of, how did you end up in Destiny Sphere? Like in that side of YouTube?
I just emailed him.
That's so interesting. Wait, were you streaming before you talked to him?
I streamed for 2 days before I talked to him.
Holy shit! Holy shit! What a way to get thrown onto the internet, though. And Destiny's... Wow!
Yeah, got inundated. So then I think because I talked to Destiny and his community liked me for a bit, I just kind of got absorbed into the Destiny, like, orbit circle. And I was interested in specifically doing politics, which is probably why I kind of found my way into this circle that I'm part of right now.
Cool.
But I'm pretty big on, like... I've never really been the type, I'm kind of the chameleon, right? Like I've never really wanted to occupy like one circle. I typically want to like be able to transition between a few. So that's cool. Why I'm doing like a dating show, because the dating show is definitely not traditional Twitch poll.
It's so good. I watched one with Eris. It's so good.
Yeah, but it's super fun. And it's like giving me access to like a whole bunch of other types of people, like E-Date girls and people who watch that kind of stuff, which is just a whole other community, which is super fun and interesting. to kind of talk to, and I might get some of them interested in politics, and maybe they'll go vote because they like are E-date people, but also like, oh, I guess politics is kind of cool, you know. So I'm very big on like blending communities and stuff.
Yeah.
Because I would say like basically like people are very used to, in your words, like bubbles, mm-hmm. and I think they don't need to be so rigid. Like if people like leave their bubble a little bit, it tends to just only be good for them, especially yes. if they have like a somewhat good experience, or at least like a neutral experience outside yes. of their bubble. Yes. That's like what I want to give people, is being like, we don't really have a fixed bubble, but.
I like that actually. No, that's why I think you do mesh well, really well with even ABBA or Destiny. Because then ABBA, I saw him on like the Flagrant podcast where all these guys were talking, and then he made an anime joke and none of them got it. And I was like, I get it. I get the joke. And then I could tell in that moment, I was like, oh, they're looking at him like he's a goober. Like, they're looking at him and he's realizing it in that moment. But that's the thing. We're always, I feel like, the weirdo in one group or another. So at some point, you got to be okay being that person. And then at some point, you got to recognize when you should change some of the things about you, because it's literally stopping you.
Yeah. I mean, sometimes I wonder if my personality is made up of being like, I mostly fit into a bubble, but there's like two things about me that are distinct enough that I don't quite like. I mostly fit into the academic like science bubble, but I have a religion, so I don't quite fit into it. Or like, I mostly fit into horse girl bubble, but like, I'm not like, I was going to say something really mean, like kind of psychotic or something like that, you know? so I don't like quite fit into that boat. Or like, I don't make like constant horse metaphors and always talk to people about my horses and stuff like that. So I don't like quite fit into that bubble. And I'm like, maybe literally my personality is just any like social group that I start to fit into, I'm like, I'm going to be just a little bit different. I just can't. Somebody made a note of like, you seem to never like labels. Like you just never want to label anything. I'm like, maybe that's my personality. I'm just like one of those edgy, like, I don't fit into your bubbles, which is dumb. But
I just feel like there's a, because even BDSM is a bubble. So when I go to BDSM dungeons, they're always like, Brittany, you don't fit in here. And I'm like, blah, 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 blah. Like, I know. Like, I'm too weird for the BDSMers.
Yeah. So is like, that because they're too extroverted or?
No, that's because they're too fucking leftist. And they're pussies. No, it's because they literally, like, I'll show up to parties and a lot of, so everyone joins BDSM for a different reason. I joined it to be fucking masochistic as hell and to find discipline in meditation. Some people join it to have sex. Some people join it just to have, like, SJW bubbles in the Pacific Northwest, right? Depending on, because some BDSM circles are really, really conservative. Like, my mentor, conservatives.
I know. Dominated. Conservatives with their sneaky sexual pleasures that they just shame everyone for and then do.
No. These are political conservatives. So they vote Trump. They vote anti-Z-Zers because they don't give a fuck about non-binary people or Z-Zer people, right? But they're liberals when it comes to sex, abortion, drugs, taxes, all this stuff. But then maybe they're business owners. But they're also BDSMers, so maybe they're anti like high tax. So maybe they're
kind of like libertarian.
They're a lot of libertarian conservatives. That's exactly who they are.
Yeah,
not religious.
Libertarian conservatives are interesting.
They're so talk about a bubble, girl. Talk about a bubble.
Very niche. Whoa. A very niche.
People thought I was a libertarian in general, and I was like, nope, never been in that bubble. Like, I've never been in that bubble, but it is a bubble because when I see them on the internet, they talk a specific way. They even dress a specific way. It is so interesting. That's what I'm saying. I'm always fascinated with what I look like to people because I cannot tell, but I know what I look like when I'm in a group of people, how to tell what I look like.
Yeah.
So it's easier. But anyways, by the way, I want to ask you, how's your time? Do you have other things today? What are you doing today?
No, my evening plans got canceled. So I'm basically, I'm going to go to the gym at some point. So
nice.
Just whenever we're done, I'll go to the gym.
Okay.
I think it's upper day today, so.
Oh, nice. I can't wait. I miss working out. My arms are, they remind me every day I'm 30.
Yeah, it's really interesting. I've started doing the thing. It must be like, maybe it's an older age thing, but I now like put fat on my face like pretty quickly. So like I gained like a couple of pounds like over the last little bit recently, and I'm just like, I can just like see it on my face. Like it's just like, it's just there. Dude. And I'm excited to go to the gym and get my cut.
Well, please do an extra rep for me in the name of Brittany, who can't work out right now. I'm excited. Like, look, ultimately, what I want to put forth into the world is that I just don't believe in any of these rules, and I think they're fine within your bubbles. But I feel like a lot of people feel really crazy because I've just felt crazy in these bubbles, girl. You have to date this way, Brittany, and you can't say this, Brittany, and you can't be this way, Brittany. And I'm like, you know what? I'm exhausted, and I'm not even on the date yet.
Yeah, I think something that I probably should emphasize more. I've said it in a couple of my dating stuff, but I'm really being clear. Like, I'm mostly talking about broadly, like, heterosexual relationships between usually cis individuals as well, right? Like, this isn't something I'd tell my brother to do when he's, like, dating, like, because he's in, like, the gay world, right? Yeah. And so it's like, this is not going to map on as well. Like, there's some things, like, learning how to flirt. Yeah. Like, That's why my KDA is designed up like just flirt. I'm not going to give you broad advice about like anything beyond that. Let's just practice how to flirt and talk to people because that transfers everywhere. Everyone needs to know how to talk to people, right? It's just a skill. But like prescriptions about dating when I'm talking about like what men and women do, I really am being pretty cis heteronormative.
Fair.
Because the reality is that still applies to 60 to 70% of the population, right? But I am interested in doing streams. It's just like, who am I to be commenting on like queer dating norms? Like, I don't know. Totally. I don't know what they are. And why would you listen to me talk about it? But that's why I've had people like poly people come on. And I just ask them questions about their experiences because I don't fucking know. But they do.
That's true. The whole makeup thing was utterly fascinating to me because I've primarily...
Men's makeup?
Well, I've also primarily only dated men who wear makeup. And kills.
Yeah,
and
I know when they were like, no, that never. And I was like, no, it's a thing.
Who is Megan Fox engaged to right now? MGK. He wears makeup, dyes his hair, and polishes his nails.
Yeah.
He's a punk.
Yeah.
So, like, if you're going to date a punk guy, he better wear nail polish. Otherwise, like, why even date a punk guy? That's, like, the perk. You know what I mean? So, but then again, I understand, like, Destiny and ABBA especially. I totally understand where they're coming from. But that's the thing, right? Why do we all talk, though? Like, this is... Even Abbott is it. This is universally true for most people. Is it, like, even if it's most people, like 51%, 60%, like, that's millions of people that we are just not tapping into. And what if these normies need to just relax? Because they all sound uptight to me, like, insecure. Like,
they definitely, normies really need to relax.
That's what I'm saying. Like, why are we adapting to normie when I'm like, hey, maybe just, like, do what you want? Because I know they feel the pressure. I know they feel the pressure. So I'm like, why are you doing this to yourself?
People gonna people.
People
I don't know.
Gonna people.
Because that's what's comfortable, right? Like, even if it doesn't make you happy. Like, here's the thing. Just because something makes you comfortable doesn't mean it makes you happy. But most people, like, when people say, like, humans want happiness. I'm like, no, they don't. They're like every other animal. They want comfort. Like, animals move almost exclusively off of, like, what's most comfortable. And that's what we do, too. That's why we go into automaton mode.
Yeah.
It's comfortable.
P.S. The chat says MGK being punk is amusing. Okay, modern pretty punk, not like 80s grunge punk. Everybody relax. See, even punk is a spectrum. I don't date pretty punk guys, but I'll date like grungy boys. But I won't date people who are all 80s punk all the time because like dress like a normal person, please. So like, see, like all of that is different too. I'm just saying like that's why I'm saying doesn't it reassure everybody that we're all single? Doesn't it make sense in the modern world where we don't have to marry for money or babies that we would be picky as fuck because we can be? Maybe I'm just aggressively in my power. I'm like in my power about it where I'm like, this is the greatest thing ever because I know if I ever find that person, do you know what I'm saying? Like it's going to be awesome.
Yeah. Just like be picky on the things that matter to you. That's all.
Values over anything else for sure. Values over things. I don't know. I'm going to talk to my family about this and be like, why do we value aesthetics so much? It's probably just a Middle Eastern thing, right? It's probably just that.
I'm not sure. It might just be like your family's like sub niche. Definitely culturally, like I definitely find like certain cultures seem to value aesthetic more. It definitely feels like a more weird white thing where we've come to really undervalue aesthetic specifically for men. It's really weird because we've never done that historically. Like if you even go back to like the 60s, like men had a very specific type of aesthetic. And unfortunately, it was a very rigid box of what aesthetic men could be within.
Yes.
And even nowadays, like the box of like where most men can occupy is like jeans
but
and a shirt.
But men are bullying other men. I'm sorry. You were giving advice to men on how to get women. And Abba and Destiny were like, no, this is gross. I'm like, for men, you are okay. Like women are looking for different things from men than men are trying to get. So why are men giving advice to other men on how to get girls?
Yeah, I mean, I love Destiny. I respect Steven on many things, but there are certain takes of his that I do not give much authority to, which would be both his food takes and his aesthetic takes.
You know what?
It's just not his forte, and that's okay. Fair. Just like you probably shouldn't listen to my political takes with much like weight versus like somebody like Destiny. Like I would trust Destiny's position on politics more than mine because he's way more informed than I am.
It's
just like I'm more informed on aesthetic. I've thought about it more.
It's just interesting.
You're probably even more informed than I am because you thought about it from your for your whole life. It's in your family.
It's true. It is in everywhere. It's every. That's a problem, though. Like, well, even Catholic. You know, there's Catholic fashion aesthetic. Like, you can tell the fashionable Catholics from that. You can tell what priests have better garments, who handcrafted things. But why do we know that? Why do I know that? Do I only know that because of my family? No, because the priest, they're all white, and my sister-in-law's white, but she knows the difference. So maybe it's like Catholic and gay. Catholic and gay, ultimate aesthetic police.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe that's it.
I think, yeah, when I think because you occupy such a, like, an, like you said, like, you don't really fit into, like, most of the boxes. Like, you really are in kind of this niche category.
Right.
When ABBA and Preach, because ABBA and Destiny have a little bit of different perspectives on stuff, I think ABBA's is a little bit more accurate. That maps onto, like, more of the broader cis heteronormative dating culture.
That
makes sense. Right? But, like, his takes aren't really going to be meaningful to somebody who's part of, like, an LGBTQ dating right. circle.
Oh, we wouldn't even consider it. We'd be like,
it wouldn't map on.
Yeah, this is necessarily. Cute. By the way, yeah. People are saying Brittany needs her partner to wear makeup. I actually don't care, and I actually prefer men without makeup at this stage in my life.
And women. You even said you prefer women.
Like, yeah, and women without makeup, because I don't wear makeup. Like, this is, again, this is my version of wearing makeup, and it's only because I'm on a live show. It's mascara and eyeshadow and lipstick. Mm-hmm. And that's only because I'm on a live show. So actually, at this stage in my life, I would prefer a partner with the least amount of maintenance possible. Because I am the least amount of maintenance possible. And I'm the kind of person who just, like, I don't want anything to stop me from, like, getting on with my day. So if I get a call from someone, they're like, let's go hang out. I'm, like, rolling out of bed. Let's go. I just want to be able to go, go, go. Versus in the past, I was like, I need to get ready. And I need 45 minutes.
mm-hmm.
So it's just about convenience. I get lazier the older I get, guys. Actually, I am getting very lazy. In the sense that I just That's want fair. Everything to be very convenient. Comfortable.
Mm-hmm.
I want a very easy life in which, girl, I made a pretty good one right now. It's pretty good.
Yeah. And I mean, like, that's the main thing. Like, when we're talking about, like, things like advice shows and stuff and people, like, get, like, really upsetty spaghetti, I'm just like, if you're happy and content and your life's working for you and you're not hurting people, then it's not for you, right?
Totally.
Like, the main reason that we come to, like, for example, like, a dating advice show is because you are discontent with it. And so, yeah. The advice not might work for you, but if you're happy and content, that's fine.
For sure.
If you're not content, there are things you can do to change that, and I can give you prescriptions that broadly seem to work for most people. It still might not work for you, but, like, this is the issue. Is, like, there's no point in, like, even looking at these things if you don't feel like you have a problem. Like, you can go from +2 to +8, I suppose, if you yeah. want to, but you don't have to.
Do you think there's, like, a what is that called when you put, like, a moral attachment to the, like, the judgment? Because I noticed that, like in BDSM circles, like, fatness is not something we think about very much, because, like, a bunch of people are fat in BDSM. And if actually if you're not fat, you're kind of, like, the anomaly, I feel like. So, and by fat I mean anything over chunky or bigger. So, like, right. And even in some circles I'm considered, like, chunky because I'm soft and I'm not worked out at all. So, like, depending on your circle, will be different. But, like, in that circle, I always find myself attracted to people. I don't long-term date people who are overweight or underweight. That's very important to me. I don't want you underweight either. Like, I have a very – but I'm in my 30s now, so okay. But, like, different things, different requirements. In normie circles, I hear a lot of things where, like, people are like, you're never going to get married if you're fat. But, like, most of America's fat and we're married as fuck. Like, I always say, go to any Walmart. They're all fat families. What are you talking about? Fat people get pussy every day. Like, even fat women are getting dick. Like, so what's the issue? And then everyone's like, yeah, but who are they dating? I'm like, other fat people. We tend to date what we are. Like, it makes sense. So, like, in my head, dating fat works because, like, there are fat people who are married every day. So why do people go around saying you're not going to get married if you're fat when most of America is fat and married?
I think because a beauty standard is still thin. I mean, right now the beauty standard broadly seems to be, like, thick. So, like, tiny waist, big bum, big thighs. But it feels like, based on the beauty trends I've been seeing, I think we're trending back towards, like, thin. And hopefully we don't get back toward, like, the 2000s thin where, like, everyone was anorexic.
So much.
That was really, really scary.
Mm-hmm.
But we are trending back towards thin. And I think it's just, like, when people say, people talk about the beauty standard is the reality, is it's thin, right? Thinner than even I am sometimes. And so...
But isn't the beauty standard that's why kind they talk of illusion about that? If a majority of fat people are married in the U.S. and they're fat?
Yes, but most standards are an illusion that nobody actually occupies.
That's what I'm saying. So how am I the crazy person who doesn't want to live within the, like, standard that I know is not even real? So then why are we all just chilling and making our own? Get out of your bubble.
Because we still kind of, this is the issue, is people still select on it. So somebody, right, there's always that weird irony where somebody themselves is, like, pretty overweight, and then they say something like, I think there's, like, actually a meme where there's this guy who's pretty overweight, and he's wearing a shirt that says, like, no fat chicks or something like that. And it's just like, what do you mean? Like, this seems like such, like, why are you having such a hypocritical standard? But again, like, the reality is, like, he gets to have that preference, but the reality is, like, probably the people that he's saying he would want to date, like, thinner people, aren't going to be selecting for him.
Yeah.
And so, I don't know, obesity and, like, whatnot and, like, being overweight is its own complex, because you're right, 70% of people in North America are overweight, adults. And it's increasingly in children. The small town I moved to, it's like, I just, like, I don't know what to, like, every, almost every child in town, we live, like, right across from, like, a couple of, like, just, like, sports centers and stuff. Most children that are going are overweight, which is just, like, very different than even, like, my childhood. Maybe it's just the small town I'm in. It could be just, like, my small town specifically. But, yeah, our relationship with weight is very strange. And then there's this resistance, right? So, like, most people are overweight. And so there's kind of this body positivity movement of, like, seeing overweight as beautiful. But then there's some resistance of being like, yeah, but also at some point being overweight isn't healthy. And do we want to, like, normalize and set, like, a beauty standard of saying this is the ideal beauty standard that's unhealthy, right? So it's like obesity in dating is a really, really, really complex thing at a sociological level, because there's even more layers going on, because it's not just aesthetic. Now we're also talking about, like, health. And then we're also talking even beyond that, character, because a lot of people connect weight to moral character as well. Right.
Right. Totally. I try not to do that part on anything. So I try my hardest not to equate, like, a moral characteristic or, like, implication with an aesthetic choice. When I, especially when I'm talking about compatibility, but at the same time, I do it, like, gay judging way, where I'm like, okay, cool. We prioritize different things. No judgment on your end. But I do get judgy if they're like, but then you should find me attractive. And then I'm like, here are all the things that are wrong with you, literally. And then I feel like a need to point it all out, but in a way that I don't even believe. It just makes me annoyed that they think they're owed a relationship. Like, why do people feel owed love? It's a very weird idea.
Because we taught people in our generation that they're owed love, that you deserve it. You deserve love. And it's like,
let me rephrase. Why do people who think they're introspective come to that conclusion?
I don't know. Because I think this is probably where maybe you and I differ. I don't think there's ever an end. Maybe you do it. Okay. Sorry.
You're okay. It's not going to bother my stream.
School has ended, and so all the high schoolers are free, and I'm like right along the main track, and so they just rip their loud cars back and forth up the road. Yeah. Sorry, I got distracted by the motorcycle. What was the question you just asked me?
The idea of, like, being owed love. Like, obviously, we hope they come from our parents, right, and our families, but then love outside of that, that feels like a really big ask from the universe.
Yeah. This is where, deserving of anything is very interesting, right? I remember, I don't know if you'll probably be fine. I remember when I first started dating my husband, and he works with homeless people. He said, homeless people don't deserve food. And I had a really big issue with that. I was really annoyed. But he grew up in a homeless shelter. He grew up, his dad was a power engineer. He grew up his entire life. He, more than anyone, really understands the homeless population, at least within our town. Like, really, really understands deeply. He's friends with lots of them, has worked with them. His parents have dedicated their entire lives, 35 years of working with these people. So it was like, it's hard to view him as a bad person for saying that, but I kind of wanted to view him as a bad person.
Yeah.
And then finally I was like, okay, well, what do you mean? Well, I had a fight about it. And I was like, well, what do you mean by that? Like, that sounds horrible. And he's like, hold on. It's really good to take care of them, but that doesn't mean that they inherently deserve it, right? And it's like this really weird thing of, like, what do we mean when we say deserve, right? There are certain things that I think, like, people, like, what do you deserve in this world? Like, are you owed anything? Or what about human rights? Do you deserve human rights, or is it, like, good that we give it to you? And so, like, then we get into this, like, philosophical quandary where it feels like in our culture, we assume that we kind of deserve everything. And the reality is, I'm like, I'm not willing to say that we deserve nothing. I still don't know if I fully agree with him that, like, people don't deserve food or something like that. But why do we deserve everything? Like, there's probably only, if we deserve stuff, it's probably just a couple of things. Mm-hmm. It's probably more so the view of like, it is good to give people these things. It is mm-hmm. good to love somebody, yeah. right? But you aren't owed it.
Right. Right. And look how in regular society, we have people, because I work with a lot of like queer on the spectrum, other people, and it's very easy for normies to look at us and be like, well, you guys, like, Brittany, you don't deserve love. You have borderline. How do you expect someone to like that? Or Brittany, like, you have an STI. Like, people aren't going to want to be with you. And I'm just like, yeah, okay, cool. Leave me alone. And then people are like, Brittany, why aren't you working harder to find a partner? And I'm like, what? And then I'm like, you know what? Fuck off. And then, like, the thing is like, I feel like we're getting a lot of mixed signals of, like, I hear people say things like people with certain disabilities shouldn't procreate because they're going to continue that disability, right? And then I think about that, too. And I think about, well, why don't they deserve love any more than you deserve love? But the thing is, like, everyone, I think, wants love to some extent.
Yeah. I think, actually, I just realized when we say something like, you deserve love, it's hard to be grateful for things that you deserve. And so, like, there's probably some level of, like, benefit of assuming that you deserve nothing so that you can be grateful for more things. Because, like, I'm going to be honest, I think gratitude is, like, so important to, like, so living. Important. Like, I think gratitude and joy, like, I know this is so, like, some mom has cross-stitched this into a pillow at some point. But, like, literally, it is – it's unfortunately true. Like, joy and gratitude are intrinsically connected. And if you say, I deserve love, then when people give it to you, they're meeting the bare minimum.
Yes.
There's nothing to be grateful for.
Yes.
Whereas it's like, no, like, the fact that, like, Nick loves me is something that I'm so grateful for. Mm. Not because I deserve it, but because he chooses to give it to me. Mm. And that's good of him. And it makes my life full of meaning, you know?
That's why I don't like the idea of people saying, like, I think that's what it is. It's like, I want to feel like, I think love is honor. Like, there's an honor to it. Like, I look at the way my mom and dad treat each other and I'm like, they are honorable and it's beautiful. And they're so grateful for each other every day. Like, my mom and dad say it. They go, we are so grateful that we found each other. And I heard that my whole life. So I think that's why I'm so resilient to the idea of people being like, and my parents also raised me to not value settling. Mm-hmm. My parents raised me to value love marriages and to be grateful for when you can find a person you really love, right? Mm-hmm. Funny enough, my mom asked me, though. She goes, Betty, are you being too picky when it comes to dating? And I said, oh, all these guys I'm almost interested in, they're too conservative. She goes, oh, I love them already. I was like, I know you do. But they don't know how to be around gay people or they're uncomfortable with queer people. So even if, no matter what I'm doing, so I'm not a good example because I'm looking for such a niche thing. But generally speaking, taking it out of Brittany world, even the most basic people I know in my life, if you want to call them basic, because I'm basic too, but like, you know what I mean? Even the most normie people in my life, they're not having a good time dating. And a big part of it is they're so afraid of being alone that I think they're giving off this really weird vibe. And like, I'm like, just stop giving off that vibe. And they're like, I can't because I secretly do need to be with someone or I'm going to die. And I'm like, oh. And so now I don't even know how to help them because I have no way to relate to that. So how do you help those people who are like, if I'm not with someone like Kyla, I'm going to kill myself?
Like, yeah. What does that even mean? It basically means like who I am as an individual is like so insufficient and I dislike myself so much that like I don't know how to exist if like I can't find meaning and like joy from somebody else. And it's a really deeply human experience. I think it's really understandable, especially if you've coming from a space of like self-loathing, because that's usually where I see it most often is somebody's like really self-loathing. And because they hate themselves so much, the only way they can kind of see meaning in life is if like life is kind of bent around another person who they think is better than them and valuable and wonderful.
Yeah.
And it's really sad because it's so understandable, but it also is tricky because it puts the person that you're loving then in a really weird situation where they're kind of carrying you emotionally.
Yes.
Because when you become like the life force of somebody else, then the responsibility of that person's life is also on you.
Yes.
And that's really scary. And when people are doing this, like the self-loather who's maybe doing this person is like putting their emotions on another person, they're not wanting to put that person in that position. And When they realize that they've put somebody in that position, it's going to reinforce all of the self-living loathing that they live with right now. So it's the most terrifying thing to realize as well, because then you have to deal with this moment of being like, I hate myself and maybe I probably should. Ooh. Like, look at what a harmful thing I was doing, right? And so like, this is like the complicated dynamic with like this situation specifically, is to like realize that. But if you haven't let go of the self-loathing, then you're fucked, basically. And like, I'm speaking from a person who's been there. Like, I've been in that position of the self-loather who now realizes that I am putting this sustaining of my life on somebody else, which is like the worst thing I could do. So, not the literal worst thing, but like one of the worst things, one of the worst things I have ever done, I guess, to somebody else. And it's hard not to then fall into, I guess I am a piece of shit and deserve no love. Because then out of that, you have to like not put your self-value on other people anymore. You have to like contain it within yourself. And then just from like nowhere, you have to just like build some sense of like self-respect, which is really hard to do.
Yeah. Which is why I think it comes down to values and what do we value. And like self-respect is something that I do value, but you can't just like be, I respect myself. Like you have to be something you respect, which is really difficult. Now, I think that fills all the, or like is all the questions that I've been mulling over. Do you have any thoughts, questions, ideas, concepts we should cover today about anything?
What are your non-negotiables? Cause we only made it 10 minutes into your, into the first date.
I know.
What are like, what's the list of questions that you go through typically?
So usually let's say they, so I've gone here a couple of times where they've like, don't believe in God. They're pro queer. Like, so those are the things I always talk about. What if we have a trans kid? It's like one of my favorite questions to ask on a date, especially to men and especially to straight men. Cause I do go on dates with straight men. Like, guys, I will go on a date with anyone that is, seems compatible. I just have preferences for the person I think I'm probably going to statistically end up with, right? So I have a preferences for those people. So if they pass all those questions, then I start giving medical history. And I try to scare them away with medical history.
Okay.
You know, and then if they...
Are you trying to scare them away or are you just letting them know your medical history?
Whatever. Same thing to me. Like, I'm trying to tell them something that they should see as a possible red flag in their book. So I'm like, hey, if this is a red flag for you, here are the things about me that are like... Here are the things about my partners I don't like. I don't like gambling. I will not date someone who gambles. I don't even care if you do it casually. No. And so, like, that's a big deal because a lot of people are like, well, is stocks gambling? Yes. If you've put all your money into fucking stocks and you have no money in your savings and no job, that is gambling and I'm not into it. Right? So, like, I went on a date with a guy who was like, I don't have a job. I live with my mom. Yes, I'm talking about the same guy again. Everyone just goes, Brittany, I mean, he's the last guy I dated. So, like, that's one-on-one date. That's why it's in my head because it's the last one. But, like, he was so funny. And he was like, I don't have a job, but I have all my money in stocks. I was like, so you don't have money? He's like, I have money. It's in stocks. I was like, that's like saying I have money in a casino. Like, you don't have money.
Depends on the stock.
But, like, yeah. But, like, then on the third conversation.
Was he doing, like, Forex or crypto? Or?
I don't know anything about stocks, girl. That's fair. But, like, when he did complain to me about work before we even went on the date. We were talking over text. And he goes, oh, I just had the worst day at work. I lost, like, so much of my money. And I'm like, again, why would you tell me this? We haven't even been on a date before. So by the time we got to the first date, okay, he was really good. It was a really nice first date. So generally speaking, very nice first date. Britney's standards, different. He wasn't a bad person. It was a nice first date. He even asked me, because I've never been on a date with a stranger like that, where it was like, he like picked me up and like, whatever, like opened the door and like did all that stuff. I was like, okay. And then he like paid for dinner. I was like, this is new. Like, I don't date people who pay for dinner because like I'm mostly the money earner in all my relationships. I really got it. I'm trying not to do that, but it's like really hard not to be. So like, okay. But so then we go through that. We go through like medical history, and then I usually go to, hey, you're not going to meet my family or know certain things about me for a while. So we're just going to talk for a really long time. And then I'm not going to tell you where I live or what state I'm in. So that might be weird because I travel to date people. I usually go to California and I date out of there, or I fly to them. Because I don't want people to know where I am, which signals that I have money, which signals she has flexibility, which signals. You know what I'm saying? So it's also very specific. But yeah, usually people don't end up being okay. Or one guy, I'll give an example. We almost got to a second date where I was like, well, he passed the first date. He didn't care about anything. But in my gut, I was like, he's saying he doesn't care, but I'm going to give him a few days. Mm-hmm. And so usually they have time to think about it, and then they're like, actually, I don't want to deal with that. Or I'll think about it and think, actually, I don't want to deal with this. Like, I really hate when guys, I don't like it when men or women keep you on the phone past your bedtime when you have work in the morning. But I know in other bubbles, including my former ones, it's romantic. And if you like mm-hmm. someone, you'll forgo sleep for work. Or no, sorry, forgo sleep for love. But my problem as a Brittany is, like, I don't do that often. And I almost never meet anyone that makes me want to do that because I have to sleep. Otherwise, I'll get triggered with my borderline within 72 hours if I don't sleep.
Yes.
So once again,
I was gonna say, for DBT, like, sleep is a pretty non-negotiable.
Exactly, which yeah. I didn't know in my past. So I think that's the other problem. So basically what I'm trying to tell them is you don't get to have those normal romantic things with me because I have borderline. But I want to in another world. I just can't. And you trying right. to do it makes me hate you because then it reminds me of all the limitations I have versus just like accepting that this is a boundary. Because that one guy, not the guy before, but the couple guys before, he was like bisexual. He had in business. Like he seemed really like almost viable, almost. He kept going like, hey, I know you're going to sleep and I know you have to do it because you're borderline, but do you want to stay up and talk to me for 30 minutes? So then he annoyed me because I was like, you acknowledged the reason I said I couldn't. You acknowledged it was borderline. And then you're still telling me to do it.
Was he telling you or was he asking you?
Same thing. It's like he's making a demand on my time that I've already set as a boundary. So asking is a pussy way of demanding.
Or it's consent gaining, I suppose.
I don't like it. It's stupid. That's fair. So, right? So like my brain's like, I don't like this. So and I said to him, I was like, oops, see this? I'm not going to go on a second date with you. You're annoying me now. Versus when I've dated girls who really know about mental health, they're like, oh, of course, call me in the morning. Like, you're adorable. I love you. Can't wait to talk to you. Flower emoji. Sleep anime emoji. Cuddle emoji. And then guess what? We have a second date in the morning. Well, not really, because they don't ever get to second dates usually over other things. But you know what I mean? It's like, I don't know what it is, but I'm looking to see if people are aware of, like, mental health. I went on this other date with this other guy. He goes, I've never met anyone with mental health. And I was like, issues. Like, nothing. No PTSD, no anxiety, no depression. And I was like, how would you even begin to understand me and my family? Who's very mentally ill.
I wonder if that's even
possible.
True.
Well,
yeah, or just like if he's not aware of people in his life that have it.
Well, they probably don't talk about it. Comes from a conservative black background. And because I also date a lot of like people of color, I date a lot of like former conservative people because, you know, we match up a lot, right? Because we have the same life story. So it could be that his family just didn't talk about mental health. But in Middle Eastern cultures, they don't believe in mental health, but they know what acting out is. Like we know what we're dealing with without saying it. If that makes sense. So yeah, so that's usually how it goes. My non-negotiables just deal with that. Or kids. Like, look, girl, as I get older, I want kids. But like, I'm going to have a cutoff date for when I'm actually going to be open to stopping, even the dream of having kids. Right? Like, I can't be 45 and having kids. Like, I know some people do it, but I just don't want to be that person.
Yeah.
So I'm going to have a time where that's like not even going to be a thing that I talk about. But I'm going to have kids around me. I want to use my retreat center as also like a summer camp possibly or like a place the kids can hang out on. So like I want kids in my life. But if I date like a business person who lives in the city and is like, oh, I never want kids. That's like a non-negotiable. But I see people do it all the time, girl. I see it all the time. Yeah. Someone wants kids, someone doesn't. And then they're in love. So they can't, they're in love. So someone has to take the hit. That's crazy to me.
Yeah, that's fair. I would say like kids is a pretty big non-negotiable. Probably people listening though are like, a lot of your non-negotiables feel like things lots of other people wouldn't care about, like sleep. But this is why I say like people get to have their non-negotiables. Just make sure that they matter. And if it's working for you, it's working for you.
Yeah.
And if people don't like it, then they probably shouldn't date you.
Exactly.
And if it's not working, then we can always talk about it in the future and like figure out like what actually matters.
But do people know that when they're dating, are they thinking, I'm going to get advice to get a date? Or are they thinking, hey, maybe I should learn who the fuck I am so I know how to communicate that on a date?
Probably, there's probably a mixture of both things going on and different people falling into different camps, I would suspect.
That's true.
Yeah.
And I also want, I know I had to date to figure myself out too. I had to fall in love and make a mistake. Yep. So I'm not saying that I assume you need to know who you are like at 19. Again, this is not what I'm saying. I want you guys to go on it. I
really encourage young people to date actually.
Yeah. Like
really, really date. And probably young people should be really open to just a multitude of things because you don't actually, sometimes you don't know what your non-negotiables are until you've been with people enough to be like, okay, yeah, anytime. And this is the issue. Sometimes people are going to use heuristics as their non-negotiables because it's just like, it seems to be the case. Like for me, I'm like, I probably would never date a doctor ever again, because every time I've had any relationship with a med student or a doctor, it's been a really terrible experience, like really terrible. Now, does that mean that there won't be doctors in the future?
Right.
That maybe would be perfect? No, you're right. There could be. But my heuristic tends to be like, if somebody's a doctor, I've already yellow flagged it.
Me because too. Of my past experience.
Which is like, you could be like, that's really dumb. But it's like, but this is also how people work.
Yes.
And so if I'm not, now I'm married, so it's fine. But if I get divorced and I'm looking and I'm having a hard time, my yellow flag doctor is probably something I could look at getting rid of, because it really is a bad heuristic. But it was helpful to me in the past.
So. Yeah. No, I actually, it's so funny you say that, because I was with this surgeon for a while and we were just mostly like lovers. But it was one of those things where I looked at her lifestyle and the way she operated and I was like, could I date a doctor? And then I was like looking at her and how she ran her life and I was like, nope, I'm too fucking needy. And also like, I don't look like an adult. Like, I don't want to be that adulty where like when she would have events, I was like, yeah, I can't pull off looking like an adult, like in a room full of doctors. I'm just obviously going to be the kid. And I'm okay with that. I'm not the kind of adult that I think will probably be an adult. Like, I probably will always be a big kid. I think that's why I like being a YouTuber. So it is kind of hilarious. You know what I mean? But that sounds crazy because everyone's like, well, don't you want to marry a doctor? They're like rich. And I'm like, no, I'm just going to make that money too. It's not that much in comparison. Like, entertainers make kind of more than doctors. So like, you know what I mean? If their career goes in that direction. So like, it's not like really a money problem, but it's a compatibility of like lifestyle too. Doctors work long hours. They're not always home. They're, you know, really tired. They have to do a lot of conferences. They're traveling for work. Like there's, you know what I mean?
They'll probably prioritize work.
They'll probably prioritize
your relationship.
Exactly. Oh, most of the time. I am needy. I am needy, girl. I need a partner that's at home, that cuddles me every night. Like, I can't date like a overnight firefighter. I'd be like, bitch, where you at when I'm sleeping? You're out there saving lives, but I need cuddles. Priorities, you know? It's like, but could I date a daytime firefighter? Sure. I'll deal with your PTSD, which I... That's the one thing about me, is I'm really good around, like, mental health issues and boundaries around disability. I'd make a really good partner for those people. Because I understand it very well, and my family understands it. So, you know what I'm saying? Yeah. We all have strengths to play to, is what I'm trying to say. And I don't think the normie bubbles offer even normie people the best for their buck. Like, the best options for their strengths.
I don't know if I would agree with you on that one. Fair. I actually think normie bubbles are pretty good for a lot of people.
Even though they have a high divorce rate and unhappiness, like...
Yes, even still.
Wow, yes. Okay. Is that just based off of data you read?
Because telling them to like date outside of it isn't actually more likely to get them happier, is mostly my view. Because I think like probably there's something wrong with how we're doing relationships. I don't think it's about like bubbles in and of themselves. Because I think I'm pretty sure in like any kind of subculture you go into, divorce rates are pretty high, excluding essentially like arranged marriages. I think arranged marriages are the only marriages that tend to like last for a really long time. But in large part, again, the culture where these marriages are coming from is going to be very different around marriage. And so it suggests to me like probably culturally, there's just the way we're doing relationships in North America either needs to change.
Or do our goals going need to back, change? Do we need to think of long-term cohabitation as not the goal?
Maybe, but then that gets tricky with kids. This is the big issue with long-term cohabitation is if you want kids, it's really hard to raise kids if you aren't going to be providing consistent caretakers for them.
Very true.
Just for like their attachment system. And so it seems like in North America, we just haven't figured out what to do with relationships. And I don't think there's like any one group that's like particularly figured out or is doing better. It seems to be, we're pretty messy overall.
See, when I hear that, I go, great, I'm just going to make up my own rules.
No.
But I think other people go, how can we fix the structure? But like the structure doesn't find you love. You find you love by interacting with people within the structure. Which, yes, if you're born in like Farm Brother was into this perfect Catholic bubble where he thrived, like his life has been so good and it's so awesome. And his wife, like her too, grew up in the same bubble and then they met. And they would say they weren't perfect in the sense that like they wanted physical differences in their partners that they didn't get. And they're like, that's okay. And she wanted him to be a little bit more empathetic and he wanted her to be a little tougher. And so it's like not a big deal, right? But they made the best out of it because ultimately they're like 90% compatible.
Right. And so that's where like when people get really picky, arranged marriages get me kind of thrown because I'm like, I don't know. I don't know if pickiness is the solution because arranged marriages, like most parents are going to ideally select a partner that like they think will be good for you. Like, most parents are loving enough to probably select a partner that they at least like. Again, there's going to be tragic stories within this.
Yeah.
But it is interesting to me of like, what do arranged marriages tell us about like what is possible? Maybe it tells us it's possible that if you just dissociate, disconnect, and resent your partner from afar, you can always make anything work. You can grin and bear through anything. But I know a lot of arranged marriages where like they're really, really happy. And so there's just, I just don't know in North America what we're doing with relationships. Mm. And I'm open to a bunch of strategies, but I don't want to be too quick to jump to like any strong assertions about things when we don't.
And I always want to leave the room open for the most weirdo person on the planet. Like, whatever works for them. But, like, my mom's first marriage was arranged, and she got divorced because he was a piece of shit. Right?
Right.
And they thought he was going to be great, and they thought it was all going to work out. And, like, it absolutely did not. And then she married my dad, who was a love marriage. And that was, like, a really big deal, right? And then I meet these arranged couples, though, who actually do stay together forever, and they're actually pretty happy. But the way that I understand it is that my mom didn't want to get married. So that was first. She was an unwilling participant in her arranged marriage. But I'm obsessed with the Indian matchmaker that kind of do modern day arranged marriages. And I'm obsessed. Like, in the future, if I can pay like $20,000 to some matchmaker to go find my the algorithmic perfect person for me, I will 100% do that. Because to me, cohabitation is not like, I could fall in love with basically anybody.
Mm.
I know that about myself because of who I've dated in the past. I'm like, how could I have fallen in love with that person? Because I have a brain that like, once I get past all my barriers, that's why I don't think falling in love means I have to be with you. So I'm looking to fall in love with someone I'm also compatible with. I can easily fall in love with someone I'm not compatible with. So for Brittany, like, falling in love is not the problem. Finding sexual chemistry is not the problem, right? It's like, do I want to wake up and tolerate you every day is the problem. Because that's like what I'm asking for. So I want our lives to be better because we're together, not worse because we're together. I don't want a harder life because we're together. I want a better life because we're together. Life is hard enough, right?
Right. So, and so I think that's something that's different that's happened in modern relationships is that that can be the goal. Whereas I think historically, like, where did a marriage originate from? Like, at least if we're talking about like Hebrew, marriage was established because specifically monogamous marriage was established as a way of essentially like to some extent protecting women and guaranteeing caretaking of the woman and the child in that society, right? Like, that was the origination. And now marriage has obviously like evolved and changed and shifted over time. But a lot of it was not the goal of like, let's be happy and sing kumbaya and be best friends. It was like, let's survive together and have procreate and make sure that the children that we create have the best success of living and being decently successful in the society.
Yeah.
Like, it seems like that's probably what marriage was for to a large portion. And so like now in modernity, like, what of that do we still need? Probably the raising of children. Like, we need to figure out how to raise children well, obviously, in future dynamic relationships. Like, that's still something beneficial. But do we need marriage to survive? Like, not really. Like, women can work, birth control, tampons. Women can't get educated. So, like, women don't really need it for, like, financial protection or anything like that.
Right.
So now what's the goal of relationships?
Okay. I kind of put it back to our Christian brains. The Old Testament reminds me of the old school way of dating where it was like very strategic and like for optimal survival of our offspring. And then the New Testament and Jesus and his lack of rules is kind of what we're doing now. We're like love marrying.
Yes.
So Brittany's brain actually prefers the Old Testament God and all his ruthless and black, white and white thinking because it allows me to know what to do next. But then I like Jesus because he's chill because I actually don't want to like blow up Sodom and Gomorrah. So that's how I look at dating, where I do want to go into it with a strategy in mind. What's our finances look like? How are we cohabitating? How are we raising children? Like, very by the book. Devoid of love. Completely logical. Then on top of that, I need the va-va-voom, homie.
Right.
I need the va-va-voom. Mm-hmm.
I think most people want the va-va-voom, right? Like, most people want...
Over?
I think so. Mm-hmm.
Is that the issue with why I think we're all kind of making mistakes about who we're with? Because, like, why are we at such a high divorce rate and, like, toxic?
Oh, man.
The amount of toxic relationships we've all allegedly been in makes me think we might just be dating the wrong people.
Yeah, and we do have the selection bias of, like, probably historically relationships were also decently toxic. It's just the goal of relationships was less to be, like, happy and not toxic, and it was more so to be, like, can we rear children decently well and safe, right? So, like, the problem is that, like, now divorces are happening because it seems like our goal of relationships is to have, like, happy, fruitful relationships, which I think is fine, by the way. Like, I think that's based.
Totally.
But then it seems like the way that we've scripted out how marriages work doesn't cater well to that very often based on a bunch of stuff.
Yeah.
I don't know. This is the thing, like what's causing the marriage problem. I don't know. I don't know what precisely to say. And something that's causing the marriage problem, some of these things are probably good enough that even though they're causing the marriage problem, we value them enough to keep them, right? Like probably one of the things that's like causing divorce rates to increase is female emancipation, right? Like women can leave their marriages if they're unhappy.
Yes, but we can, girl.
I don't really want to roll that back. Like I don't want women to not be able to like be able to leave their marriages or like have financial freedom. Like I don't want to go back to that. So this is the issue.
That's what
like
I'm saying. I think we're in a transitional period where we're just like in a, oops, things are changing. But like, yeah, I'm not, girl, I would never want to be born at any other time than now. Girl, no. I'm not like online. I'm like naked and people aren't stoning me to death. Like I'm living my best life. Do not mess with me, please. Like, yep. You know what I mean?
I'm still for horses instead of cars. I will never move. I've decided it to be my irrational thing. I want trains, just to be clear.
I like expeditious
travel. I just want cars to be removed.
I just
want to
drive fast, though. Oh, can I horseback ride fast, though? Okay, we can. Maybe I can make this work. Maybe
that's
make
true.
It work, honestly.
It feels very fast when the wind's in your face. I mean, not as fast as like a motorbike, but.
I can't hold my Starbucks and ride a horse, though, can I?
You could still for sure die if you fell off of a horse at a dead gallop.
So I guess it'd give me that adrenaline thrill of almost.
The adrenaline, like the risk.
Yeah, that's a good
point. If you want the risk. There's high risk with horses. They could stumble and just fucking fall.
Bro. That scares me. True. The idea of them hitting like a little boop and there's like,
yep.
You know what I mean?
Yep.
That does actually
scare usually
me.
When they fall and roll, it's not too bad. I've actually like had a horse dead gallop and fall and roll and you just kind of like, you just kind of roll.
Now remind me, was your head injury from a horse?
It was from show jumping. It's different. Yeah.
And you still love horses even though they hurt you.
True.
You're in a toxic relationship with horses.
I am in a toxic relationship. Actually, I haven't ridden at all this year.
Really? So. How do you do it? Because I know some people like go to places or they have a horse they keep. Do you have a horse or do you?
So I had a horse for, since I was about 12, I've had two different horses. Mm. But I sold him almost 2 years ago now I sold him actually. He was getting pretty old. He was a rescue. Mm-hmm. So he was pretty... had a couple of nuts loose.
Neurodivergent?
More like traumatized.
Yeah,
he was pretty badly abused before I got him. So we did dressage and like trail riding and mountain riding together, but he was just a spook fest. And I had been dumped by him enough times that like, I can't risk getting thrown off too much anymore because of my neck.
Yeah.
So I need like a really quiet horse now. Whereas like before I was like training fillies and like young horses, I can't do that anymore. I can't even show jump anymore.
Do you have any
too risky.
Fear like yeah, it's too risky.
Absolutely.
So like okay, so like we won't. Okay.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, unfortunately there's this issue of like horse riding is this weird thing that I think I've mostly grieved it of like I'm probably never going to be able to ride horses like I used to.
Yeah.
Because there's too much fear connected to it and the fear is really well grounded. Like I'm not being hyperbolic in my fear. I could die. Because my neck at C1 is still a little bit deviated from where it should be sitting.
Right.
So yeah. Horses, my relationship with horses is very different. Like now when I ride a lady's horse, they're very quiet. They're
so
Frisian
like,
dressage
like
horses.
Like sad saddle or something? Like what do you mean a lady's horse? I don't know what that means.
Oh, no, just this lady. They're not just not
oh,
mine. So
this lady's
woman,
horse.
This lady's with like a ownership,
yes.
Apostrophe, whatever
yes.
It's called. Yeah.
Got you.
So she owns these Frisians that she's trained for dressage. They're really calm and quiet. And I ride those horses for her.
Mm, we live in obviously like the country. So there's a lot of horses. We also have wild horses. Like they're just like wild. And I'm like, oh, look, there's a whole pack of horses. And like, they're just wild. And it's the coolest thing in the whole world. But like
that's
our family
cool.
Friend has horses too. And there's this most, I don't know what kind of horse it is, but she's the prettiest thing I've ever seen in my whole life. She's like the most beautiful auburn coat in the whole world. And a little diamond on her forehead, a white diamond. I don't know if that means something. But like
yep,
she
little
is.
Star.
Yeah. It's so beautiful.
Don't get me into horse girl. I know it all.
You need to like literally I'll just like show you like I'm like what's this one because like they're so
was
beautiful.
Was she like blonde or brown?
No, she was brown
like
and
the color
auburn
of my door?
Like the kind of the color of your door but darker.
Okay, so a chestnut.
And like a chestnut, yeah. And like there was like a little bit of that like just like in the sun especially I was like oh my gosh, like how can a banimal just be so beautiful?
Yeah.
Oh
yeah, my horse was also, he was called a sorrel, so he was this color. The door is pretty close to what his color was, and then he had a blonde mane and tail with really big white tall socks and a big stripe down his face.
Cute. He's
very, he was, we would call, so when horses have lots of markings, we call them chromy. Like they have good chroma. Yeah, like good chromosomes.
Oh, cute. Yeah, so wait, chromy. Marks are so good because they're marks. Distinctive?
Depending on the breed. So like okay. on a quarter horse, having distinctive like socks and marks on the face are called chromy, but you don't want like blotches. Like if they're a paint, that's a different type of horse.
You wow. don't want a quarter horse. There's to even be a hierarchy in prettiness in horses.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah. Wow. And then it's prettiness is determined exclusively by breed. Like the traits you select for in a Friesian are very different than you select for in like quarter horses are weird because there's like four actual categories of quarter horses. But yeah, like a foundation quarter horse, you don't want them to look like a race quarter horse.
Yeah. Okay. I love it. But also, do you ever like sit there and wonder like, why do we do this to ourselves?
Sometimes I sit there and I wonder, how is it that I have such a massive body of knowledge around, like I know a lot about horses and I never tap into it anymore. Oh, just like this entire portion of this entire section of my brain is just like, we're useless now.
If you literally, if you ever come to visit and you, I will introduce you to my family friend who is a horse lady to the T, but literally like in her retirement, she's donating her horses to this like horse facility that's like 30 grand each horse. And that's how she's spending her money. She's a millionaire. She can, that's what she's spending her money on, horses. She didn't have kids.
All right.
And her husband passed a few years ago. And so that's what she does with her money now. She just adopted a new horse, a rescue. And she just like collects them. But she has, I don't know what they're called, but they're really pretty, but they look like surfers. They're like blonde and they have like lots of hair and they are like really fluffy in the winter. They get like their winter coats. And they kind of look like
Clydesdales. Are they a Przewalski? I don't, are they a Przewalski horse? Do they have like a stripe, a black stripe down their back or anything?
No.
Are they very chunky?
Yeah.
Are they Belgians? They might be Belgians.
Oh, I think maybe.
Like really tall?
They're pretty, I can't tell if they're stocky and short, like, or if they're tall. They're kind of stocky, but they're kind of big. Like they're intimidating to me.
Yeah, so if they're really tall, they'd be like a Belgian. Mm. If they're shorter, they might be like a Percheron or something like that.
I'll ask her.
Or they might just be a mutt. Might be a mutt horse, too.
She's kind of picky about her horses.
Yeah, if she's spending 30 grand, then they're probably not mutts.
She's kind of picky. Yeah, she's very, like, she knows everything about horses. Like, she'll just look at a horse and be like, that's that and that's that. And I'm like, so you guys might that's be future me. Best friends.
Yes. I actually don't dabble too much into that because horse world gets really weird really quickly. You know, it's like, you know, like music people, like my one friend, I can just be like, what pitch is that refrigerator humming at? And she can be like, that.
Yes.
See, that's a cool skill. The skill of like pointing at a horse and me telling you like what's wrong about its conformation and like how it's going to break down when it's 22. That's not really a sellable skill. It's not interesting. It's not cool.
I think it's kind of hot, though. No, I think it's hot. I'm going to be real.
Like, hey, I do well at the race course. I can always tell you which horse will not run well.
I would date a horse girl. I date a horse girl because, one, I think horses are really grounding and earthy and meditative. But also, I'd be like, tell me everything about horse. I don't even research horses in my free time, girl. But yeah. I don't know why. That's a subject I will let my partner rant about, even though I know nothing about. Because I'm like, that's actually, I like horses enough to listen to this. And like that would be interesting.
It's pretty interesting because we've been selectively breeding them for so long that like there's some really weird factoids around horses.
See,
have you ever seen a mar? You know what? You should look up a marwari horse.
I can't, girl. You expect me to know how to spell that word?
M A R W A R I.
Whoa, 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 whoa. M A
A R
R
W A R war.
W A R
I. And then space, right, horse as well.
Perfect. Also, I'm like slightly dyslexic, and it's enough that it's like takes me a really long time to like read or write things. So like, okay. I have a lot of problems, yeah. Kyla. A lot of problems. Oh my gosh. What? These ears.
Right? I'll pull it up on stream so everyone can see because they're probably curious.
Oh yeah, I should have pulled it up.
They're like my favorite. They're my favorite type of horse.
My dream
is to own one.
I'm afraid of opening up too many windows, guys, and my stream's crashing. So you can look this up yourselves. Here, I'll share it to Discord. This is crazy looking. I kind of like it, hate it. Is it weird that I hate it like it?
Yeah, that's how I feel about it. It's like so weird because they're like little devil horn ears.
Yeah, it's kind of ugly, kind of pretty.
Yeah. And like, they're like a desert horse. So they're very like, they're very lean and elegant.
They, oh, that's what they look like. They look like mean and elegant.
Yeah.
Is that what you
they
just
kind
said?
Of are.
Yeah, that's what they
look. I said lean.
Oh, lean. Like I heard muscular, mean.
But they are kind of mean, too.
They kind of look like they got attitude because they think they're pretty. And I'm like, look, bitch. Okay. Okay. Ooh, this one's interesting looking, though.
Yeah. They're pretty fun. If you want more, desert horses are really weird. Some of the stuff they've selectively bred for. There's one horse that's metallic, actually. All of their coats are metallic.
Like a copper?
Metallic, copper, like golds, and silvers, typically, yeah.
What?
And they're really, really shiny. They're called an achaltique. I can spell it for you if you want to
look spell it for up. Me.
Okay, it's A-K.
A-K.
H-A.
L?
L.
Dash T. It came up.
T-E, yeah.
My Google's like, we are now a horse girl. And like, it's like.
Yes. So like one of the most popular ones, the most beautiful horse in the world is an achaltique. It's a Cremello metallic.
Whoa. This horse is literally orange and black.
Yeah.
This is crazy. I'm going to send it to the Discord peeps so you can see my screenshots here.
Yeah.
Oh my goodness. Wozers. Yeah.
The supermodel. Why? The supermodel.
It's so world. It looks kind of underweight though. Looks a little Paris Hilton 2001.
They're very slim. They're very slim horses. They are not good for a lot.
Yeah, except this for one, looking nice. This one kind of looks like a crazy dog. Do you see it?
Yeah, yeah. They're not they're not athletic. They can't carry riders that are over a certain weight. I mean, no horse can carry it past a certain weight, but like
really?
They can carry, yeah. So like when I did dude string, so that's like trail riding for non-horse people, basically we call it dude string trails.
Okay.
And so the horses you guys ride, we call them dudes because they're duds, and then we call them dudes.
Aww, I don't know. Babies.
Yeah. Yeah, once you get in the horse world, we get a lot of weird words for stuff, but
judgy.
When we get different riders, we actually have to have certain body weights for certain horse sizes because you can actually like damage their, because you're sitting on their back, their
of
spine.
Course,
right?
So, of course. Yeah. Now, how fat phobic is horse world?
Decently, because there's a lot of judgment. Like if you're pretty heavyweight and you're riding a pretty low weight horse, you're actually doing damage to that animal.
Right.
And then there's also stuff like if you're show jumping and you're pretty heavyweight, and your horse's back isn't solid for that. When your horse jumps, it's got the force of landing and your body force like connecting as well, right? And obviously, like if you're a good rider, you're not just like slamming dead right. weight on them. But if you ever fuck up, you could really hurt your horse's back. So it's decently fat phobic, I would say, to an extent. But again, like a lot of Western world is really into like deep fried shit. So it's kind of the weird irony.
Girl, yeah. Our food, like even like talking to my nutritionist and she's like she'll tell me to get things. And I'm like, okay, look, I don't know how you fucking Australians do shit, but I don't know what you're talking about. And she's like, just get organic, fresh, blah, 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 blah. And I'm like, okay, ma'am. In my small American town, I have a Walmart. So can we work with that? And she was just like, and like, it's even our food. Actually, when I was like in my hardcore leftist days, we talked about that, how obesity is also, it was like in some countries and cultures, like a sign of wealth, but in America it is kind of a sign of like not wealth.
Yes.
Right.
Actually.
Yeah. So like, that's been the most interesting thing to me. And it's just like the things they put in our foods, even our organic food though, girl, like even in America, our organic food is not, it's like, not really organic. It's not even good for you.
Yeah. And it's, yeah. I mean, this is the interesting thing about like modern world poverty is often marked by obesity, right? Like if you go to Greece, typically like as their poverty has dramatically increased, so has their obesity because the cheapest food to purchase is typically like highly processed, really unhealthy foods. Yeah.
Yes. Isn't that so funny? So like I usually hear conservatives will say like, well, if they're so fat, how can they afford to eat all that food? I was like, you know what? They don't have to eat a lot to put in those calories. That's what's so crazy. Because like with my nutritionist, even my kombucha, which is GT Dave's baby, and like I'm thinking it's healthy, it's going to be great. But for someone who can't consume sugar, me, it has like 18 grams of sugar. And I'm like, so like, and I have to sit there and I'm like, so can I, how much of this can I have a day? She's like, maybe a half a glass, maybe. And I was like, okay, because it causes inflammation. And I was like, okay, so I have to be careful about my pain. But then again, if I want to, I don't know. I already cheated this morning. I had French fries. I'm not supposed to. I went to a Mexican place and they had carne asada fries. And it's like
food limitations for health is brutal because you're not even doing it for anything other than like, I don't want to feel pain later, but you're like, but I won't feel pain now. Mm. I'll just feel the joy of French fries, you know?
Literally me this morning as I was eating it at 9 a.m. I was like looking at everyone. I was like, I just got my blood drawn. This is my gift to myself. And I can't wait to have more later. But yeah, literally it's the pain is insane though. But like, I forget how much it hurts until like 6 hours from now. I'm going to remember.
Yes,
I'm going to remember.
Yeah.
Oh my God. Okay, by the way, this convo has been really, really nice. How have you felt about it?
Good. Yeah, it was super fun. I'm sad I only made it to 10 minutes. I wish you had asked any other question about the really. I feel like I wouldn't have failed as quickly.
No, you probably wouldn't have. Because I do want
to live in the country.
Yeah, you probably wouldn't have. That's the thing. We could do it again if you'd like. And like, we could do it. No, it's okay. But like, that's the thing is like, I've been on dates where, and that's the problem. I feel so bad, Kyla. I feel like an asshole sometimes because I'll be on these dates and these guys are like, holy shit, you're like the girl of my dreams. I'm like, paused. And I'm like, I know we're doing all the stuff we have in common, but let me get to all the stuff I hate in people. Because like, that's the problem is like, I am really chill in some lights. In some lights, if you only see Brittany being like, one way, you're like, oh, cool, she's never this way. But no, I'm this way too. Hmm. It just, like, depends on the context, which is why I think when you're dating, you need to see somebody in, like, all of their contexts to really know. But see, I only want to see their context after I decide I like them. Because I have to like – it takes me so long to like people, like, sexually, romantically. Really? Oh, sexually
– Oh, romantically.
Sexually is fast. It's like – but romantically – my track record as of now in all my three adult relationships, each single one took about 6 months.
Oh, wow.
And we were having sex the whole time. But we weren't dating. And I was like, I'm just not interested in you. They're like, but we have so like such good sex. We get along. We're friends. We hang out. And I'm like, no. And I was right in all of them. For the same reason I didn't want to date them in the first place, I dumped them in the last place about it. We're not compatible. We don't have the same values. We don't have the same goals. And yes, the sex is good. And yeah, we're friends and we can hang out and laugh. And I like your parents and they like me. But what does any of that shit matter when we come home every day and we're like literally disagreeing on how to spend money or how to raise our kids?
Yeah, I think we really undervalue the like domestic economy and like how important, like if you guys disagree about how you manage cleaning the house, you're going to be fighting about that almost every day unless one of you is willing to compromise, right? Like you'll fight. This is the biggest issue plaguing Nick and I is that we disagree quite a bit on house orderliness and cleanliness. And like, it's always an issue in large part because like when I get distressed, my need for cleanliness vastly increases.
Yes.
And because of my like childhood trauma stuff, I live in like some level of like perpetual hypervigilance. Right. And so it's like the more calm I am, the less I care about it. So it's hard for him to like care that much about meeting me like as high as I am because he knows like a large portion of it is just like my stuff basically. And like how do I ask him to meet me when I know it's my, especially now that I know, I'm like, I know it's my stuff, it's for sure my stuff. I like because cleanliness and orderliness are different, like mine is for sure about like clutter and stuff like that. Like it's just like, you know, I hate like my desk looks like this, right? Like it's decently clean and like to me this is cluttered, like it's annoying me how cluttered my desk is, right? So Yeah. That's a big thing that people need to figure out is like if you need to figure out house economy. Like if you really disagree on this stuff, it can be really hard on relationship.
Yes. Well, even earlier today, my brother, we were talking, two of the brothers and I were talking and then one of them was listening. He goes, hey, why are you guys complaining about me making the kitchen table into my desk? If you guys had an issue with it, why didn't you tell me 3 months ago? I was like, because we live in a really poorly designed home that will not allow you a space in order to work. So I've given you my kitchen table. And instead of freaking out about it, I have disassociated my feelings in association of having, in relation to having an adult kitchen table that I can give, like offer to guests. So yes, I would rather you live with me because I know the economy is hard and I love you and I'd rather you be here. And I'd rather have a kitchen table, but not in like not at the sacrifice of you not having a desk to work at / you leaving this house.
Right.
So they're my siblings and we all know this is temporary and I love them enough to be like, not a big deal, not a big deal, not a big deal. Meditate, meditate, meditate. But yes, when I go downstairs and these boys are in their 20s and they don't fucking want to clean and I'm like the only person who's like, please. And like the gay one too, the gay brother's here. He's like, please, let's just like clean. And everyone's like, no. And I'm like, it's like, and it's everything, girl, from dusting the vents to like cleaning the like the details, the stuff that you never did as a kid. Because why would you? And look, in my 20s, I was filthy. So I am not about to lecture my brothers in their 20s about how they have to be perfect because I most certainly was not. Mm-hmm. So I'm able to like be like, okay, this is not my issue. But for dating, marriage, girl, you are fighting the battle of a century. God bless you, and I wish you the best.
Well, I think what I'm realizing is, like, at least for me, I would prefer dirty socks everywhere to know that I get to, like, come home to Nick. Aww. I would,
yeah.
You know, when we were separated, I missed dirty socks too. Because yeah. If the dirty socks are there, then he's there. And I really like him there. And so I can let go about, like, the cleanliness stuff. I can try to at least. I mean, I'm sure as I'm saying this, he's like, let go. For sure. Right. But yes, ma'am. Yeah, I don't know.
I think that's
just, he matters more to me than dishes. And so I'm really lucky in that, like, when it comes to house economy, he's really willing to work with me because he agrees. You want to have the house economy figured out because you don't want to be fighting about something every day. And I think we mostly have our stuff figured out. It's just, like, probably annoying for him that, like, I have such a high standard about it. And it's a little annoying for me that he has a low standard about it. But yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Everyone's always ooh-ooing over Nick every time I talk. Ooh. Everyone's like, he's so amazed. He is, because Nick spent his whole life deciding, I want to be a father and a husband. That's what I want to be in my life. Those are my two goals. So he spent his whole life cultivating himself to be the best at those two things. And that's he good. Is. That's I great. Spent my whole life cultivating how to be a good academic and, like, worker. I'm really fucking good at that shit. But I didn't actually spend most of my life cultivating the traits needed to be, like, a good wife. And so, like, I'm lagging behind him on that stuff.
That's really interesting. Is he a stay-at-home partner?
He works. He's actually making more than I am now, now that I'm just streaming. So he personal trains, but the gym that he works at is actually just across the street. Cool. So when he trains, he just, like, waddles over there, and he does a lot of online training from now my streaming as well. So
that's a really nice gig. That's a nice setup for both of you, actually. That's really awesome.
Yeah. So that's super fun. It was a very good choice moving here so that he could.
Cool.
He's got a business, so we've been getting it off the ground for a while.
You know what I like about your relationship is that because you guys started off young together too, you got to grow together and, like, figure these things out as you went, which is so nice in so many ways, because then you really orchestrated, like, an ideal combining of selves.
Yes. I think that's a lot of things when I talk to, like, my friends that are older, like 30, 31, 32, it's a lot harder to find a partner because, like, who you are and, like, what you prefer and stuff is just so much more set. And I think a large part of, like, what determines, like, what your preferences are on things is probably just environmental. And so if your environment is the same as, like, your partner, it's going to be more likely that you'll end up at the same conclusions about, like, certain things. So that's definitely one of the benefits to dating and marrying young. Yeah. But there's obviously major cons in that, like, if you don't know who the fuck you are and then you figure it out when you're 27 and they're wholly incompatible, then your relationship's fucked.
So. Oh my God. It's so dependent. Like, Farm Brother got married so young and he always asked me, like, why couldn't you do this? Because I'm not that human. That wasn't my journey, and I accept that. I needed to date and be messy and do horrible things to figure out what I wanted, and I think I'm better for it. But at the same time, I'm so happy for him that he was so lucky, and, like, he's so grateful to have found that person so young, because damn, girl, they're, like, in the best part of their life. 4 kids, farm, everything. They're already living it. It's wonderful. It's really fire, honestly. I'm happy for them. I am. All right, girly, I think this is a good time to end, maybe?
Yeah.
Okay.
Feels like a natural stopping place.
Thank you for joining me, by the way. I'm so glad I hit you up, and you were so quick to reply and so eager, and I just appreciate that so much.
Absolutely. I'll definitely be honest. I'm definitely probably quicker to reply with you, some of my more favorite people than others. So other people listening mean, like, what do you mean she's quick to reply, that bitch? It's
true. Well, I'm happy to be that person grateful. That I get to be that person. There, that's me being grateful today. And also, please hit me up anytime you ever need anything from me. Not that I have much to offer, but if you ever need anything, I'm here.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, no, I super appreciate. Me and Nick were talking about you the other day of, like, people that we, like, trust and stuff like that. And I was already? Like, I feel like online. Yeah, I feel like I really trust you. Like, I just trust you. Because, like, here's the thing. We're going to disagree on, I think we've already disagreed on a couple of things. But I fully trust you to, like, A, tell me, and B, to be who you say you are. And so I know that who you say, like, what your values are, I know I can predict that. And that's, like, the biggest thing for me for trust is, like, I just want to be able to know that, like, I can reliably expect something from somebody. And if it's going to be different, they'll tell me. And I'll obviously have grace for people. But I don't know. That's just a big thing for trust.
Yes.
For me.
Like, no, I feel the same exact. I just told my sister. I was like, I think I have a new friend. And she's like, really? And I was like, yeah. And her name is Kyla. And I was, like, talking about you. I was like, I'm so excited. I think we might, like, another, because I really value my female relationships. And I really value, like, women who are analytical and who don't seem bothered by me.
Yeah, especially in this space. It's been really nice finding like you. I'm like hoping that me and Aristocracy might like have a good friendship, and like Melina, because it feels like, especially in the political space, it's so mask all the time that I'm like, I need the femme. Like I need it. Otherwise, I become a mean person when I'm only in mask energy all the time.
Yes, exactly. So, exactly. Yeah. All right, girly. Thank you much so much for this time. Okay. Please, guys, go check out Erudite's channel. We really need to. I watch her almost every night when she's on, because by what time you go on, I'm in my like end of the night stuff. I'm like, perfect. Wind down. So like, she's really, really great to watch. I really like her live shows. They're really good. They're really entertaining. Thanks. They're really good. Yeah. All right, girly. Talk to you soon.
Okay. Have a good one.
You too. Bye. Bye.